instigation.
No hesitation. One of the great memories of all time. I don't remember much about that meeting. It was a very unimportant meeting. Took place for a long time. Don't remember much about it.
I didn't realize how bad my smile was with fillings and root canals. I had to do something. I looked at partial bridges. I looked at dentures. Out of all the options, ClearChoice was the only choice for me.
At ClearChoice, we bring hope to millions who suffer from missing or failing teeth with dental implants that look, feel, and function like strong, natural teeth.
All the specialists with all the technology they need are in one spot. That makes delivering this 21st century world-class dentistry very easy to do, and we do it in one day.
I can laugh, people crack a joke, and I smile. It was a life-changing thing.
Call today to schedule your free comprehensive consultation, an ICAT 3D imaging scan. We'll even talk financing options while you're here.
They not only helped rebuild my smile, but helped me to rebuild my self-confidence. They really set me free. I mean, look at this smile.
At Clear Choice, you're about to discover what you've been missing all these years. Call Clear Choice today.
When you're looking for answers, it's good to have help, because the right information at the right time may make all the difference. At Humana, we know that's especially true when you're looking for a Medicare supplement insurance plan. That's why we're offering this fact-filled guide, 7 things every Medicare supplement should have. And it's yours free, just for calling 1-888-311-3547. You see, Medicare covers only about 80% of your Part B medical expenses. The rest is up to you. That's why so many people purchase Medicare supplement insurance plans like those offered by Humana. They're designed to help you save money and pay some of the costs Medicare doesn't. Depending on the Medicare supplement plan you select, you could have no deductibles or copayments for doctor visits, hospital stays, emergency care, and more. You can keep the doctors you have now, ones you know and trust, with no referrals needed. Plus, you can get medical care anywhere in the country, even when you're traveling. With Humana, you get a competitive monthly premium and personalized service from a healthcare partner working to make healthcare simpler and easier for you. You can choose from a wide range of standardized plans. Each one is designed to work seamlessly with Medicare and help save you money. So how do you find the plan that's right for you? One that fits your needs and your budget? Call Humana now at 1-888-311-3547. That's 1-888-311-3547. Agent producer can answer any questions you have and help you choose the plan that's right for you. The call is free and there's no obligation. You know Medicare won't cover all your medical costs, so call now and see why a Medicare supplement plan from a company like Humana just might be the answer.
Publishers Clearinghouse is ready to award the new Turnback Time Prize. 10 years of back payments right away. That's $2.6 million. Then $5,000 a week for life. Don't miss your last chance to win. Enter at PCH.com now on December 22nd. It could be you.
This is an apple. You can look at it from the left. You can look at it from the right. But it doesn't change the fact that this is an apple.
I'm always amazed at how far people travel to come to Floors USA. And the minute they walk in the door, they know why their friends told them to come here.
It's our annual Fall Savings Days. If it's in stock, it's on sale. And for a limited time only, get 36-month interest-free financing on the largest selection of in-stock flooring and area rugs under one roof in the Delaware Valley. Hurry in. If it's in stock, it's on sale. Plus, no interest until 2020.
Floors USA. Better flooring at better prices, guaranteed.
He gets a lot of compliments. He wears his army hat. Walks around with his army shirt looking all nice. And then people just say, thank you for serving our country. And I'm like, that's my dad.
No one deserves a warmer welcome home. That's why we've hired more than 13,000 members of the military community since 2010.
I'm very proud of him.
Comcast.
This is Life with Lisa Lane. Sundays at 10 on CNN.
We're getting new reaction tonight to President Trump publicly venting his frustration that the Justice Department isn't going after Hillary Clinton and the Democrats. Republican Senator Bob Corker says the president is pressuring federal authorities to pursue cases against political opponents. Strong words from the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. Let's bring in our analyst and specialist, Susan Hennessy. The president was specifically asked just before leaving the White House. I'm going to play the clip for you and our viewers one more time. It's hard to hear the specific question. I'll read the specific question. Would you fire Jeff Sessions if the Justice Department doesn't take action against Hillary Clinton? Listen to the exchange.
I'm really not involved with the Justice Department. I'd like to let it run itself. But honestly, they should be looking at the Democrats. They should be looking at Podesta and all of that dishonesty. They should be looking at a lot of things. And a lot of people are disappointed in the Justice Department, including me.
And he also said, let me read it because we didn't play that clip. Would you fire Jeff Sessions if the Justice Department doesn't take action against Hillary Clinton? The president said, I don't know.
Yeah, so these are really profoundly troubling statements. Look, in the same breath, Trump is sort of saying, well, I don't have anything to do. I don't run the Justice Department. And then calling for investigations into his political opponents. That really is part of a pretty remarkable trend of behavior that we've seen from Trump that really is threatening to sort of this principle of independent law enforcement. Now, the president does need to have some communications with the attorney generals, some communication with the Department of Justice. Where that line falls is he should not be having active communication or commenting publicly at all on ongoing active investigations. That's not a line that past presidents have struggled with at all. And yet again and again, we see Trump sort of unable to respect this really, really important and fundamental principle.
Yeah. And Ron Brownstein, the Republican Senator Corker, the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, put out that strong statement. Let me read a sentence or so from that statement. Like me, most Americans hope that our justice system is independent and free of political interference. President Trump's pressuring of the Justice Department and FBI to pursue cases against his adversaries and calling for punishment before trials take place are totally inappropriate and not only undermine our justice system, but erode the American people's confidence in our institutions. Do you believe other Republicans will join Senator Corker in making statements along those lines, blasting the president for those words?
Look, this is a very profound moment because of others have said on this show, what we are hearing from the president is more like what you hear in an authoritarian regime where he's urging the law enforcement officials to take action against his political opponents. You know, I had a conversation a few months ago with a top law enforcement official from the Obama administration, and I was saying I really have no idea what this is going to look like, this Trump presidency in 18 months, whether it will be seen as successful or blowing up or how Republicans. And he said, that's probably right, but we have no question about how it will look in 50 years. And I think this is one of those moments where Republicans have to realize that the judgment of history is looking over their shoulder. And if they want to basically say, well, this is a Twitter controversy and I'd rather talk about tax cuts while the president is threatening to kind of cross this very historic line, this critical line between a democracy and something that is less than that, that is a very profound statement on their part that I think is not going to look very good in 50 years.
Let me let Phil Mudd weigh in on this. You not only used to work at the CIA, you also worked at the FBI, and you hear the president in his tweets and in his statement saying not just the Justice Department, but the FBI has to start investigating Hillary Clinton, or as he calls her, crooked Hillary, and the other Democrats.
I don't think the American people understand how profound what the president's, how profound his statement is. We live in a country that has a gift that we take for granted. If you're black, if you're white, if you're Christian, if you're Jewish, regardless of ethnicity, justice is blind. When you serve at the FBI, you follow the facts. If those facts lead you to a crime, you prosecute the crime going through the Department of Justice. What the president has suggested is that regardless of the facts the Department of Justice finds, the political branch of government, that is the president, should be able to decide who gets investigated. When President Putin does that against political opponents, we sanction him. When President Trump does that, we say this is a little weird. One more point here, Wolf, and this is critically important. The president just undermined any prospect that the Justice Department would do that. Obviously, as you know, the department declined to pursue charges against Secretary Clinton. Let's say they reopen that case tomorrow. What would everybody say? They'd say that's as a result of the political pressure from the president. He's not even thinking enough in a sort of Tillerson moment, a moronic moment, not even thinking enough to realize that by saying that, the prospect the Justice Department does it is near zero. Not a good move.
And in his statements and his tweets, David Axelrod, the president specifically said they got to do this, the Justice Department and the FBI. In one tweet, I'll read it to you. Pocahontas, he's referring to Senator Elizabeth Warren, just stated that the Democrats, led by the legendary crooked Hillary Clinton, rigged the primaries. Let's go FBI and Justice Department. I want to get your reaction as well.
Well, look, I agree with everything that has been said. You know, when I was in the White House, everybody was under strict orders that not to talk to the FBI, not to talk to the Justice Department, that those discussions, any questions should be routed through the White House counsel. The president was very circumspect about talking about these things because this is fundamental to the rule of law and the nature of democracy. I think what's happened here is the president had a very bad week with these indictments and the plea of Mr. Papadopoulos, and this story is snowballing, and he's trying to create a massive misdirection play, but he's doing it at great cost to a fundamental institution in our society.
Susan, let me get to you, because you're a lawyer. You were an attorney over at the National Security Agency. Have you heard anything like this going on before from an American president and to this degree?
Well, no, certainly many of sort of the post-Watergate reforms were actually designed to memorialize and institutionalize this really profound wall. David referenced the fact that all communications are supposed to go through the White House counsel's office. The problem is that because the president does need to have some communication on sort of high-level law enforcement priorities, we really do have to trust him as an individual to care about sort of being an appropriate the door for somebody like Trump to just say, well, I don't care about that. I'm going to say whatever I want without thinking about the long-term consequences here.
All right, everybody stand by. There's much more we need to assess. I want to get your reaction to the president's Twitter account going down for 11 minutes. People are laughing about that, wondering about it. But does it represent potentially a national security threat? Stand by.
Make an entrance with Joseph A. Banks' Buy One, Get One Free Sale on almost everything in store. Plus, all traveler and 1905 suits, $249. And all dress shirts, including our best-selling traveler shirt, two for $89. The Buy One, Get One Free Sale, only at Joseph A. Bank.
We wanted to sell our home and at the best price, and we needed a real estate agent who could get that done. We're so glad we found HomeLight. HomeLight ranks over 1 million agents based on their actual track record. They crunch the numbers to figure out who is best in your neighborhood, who can sell your home for the most money. HomeLight matched us with Alex. He sold our home in only 2 days for $40,000 over asking. When it's time to sell, the place to go is HomeLight.com.
Forge of Empires. Develop your own city from the Stone Age to modernity. Available in the App Store and at FOE.tv. Forge of Empires. Play now.
We opened our doors with 70 megawatts, 35 mules, and an ice plant. But we brought power to the people, redefining what that meant from one era to the next. Over 90 years later, we continue to build as America's third largest investor in infrastructure. We don't just help power the American dream, we're part of it. This is our era. This is America's energy era. Next Era Energy.
We're on to you, diabetes. Time's up, insufficient prenatal care. And administrative paperwork, your days of drowning people are numbered. Same goes for you, budget overruns. And rising costs. Wipe that smile off your face. We're coming for you too. At Optum, we're partnering across the health system to tackle its biggest challenges. Optum, how well gets done.
You guys don't happen to know a good handyman, do you?
Maybe.
Outstanding. Could you possibly do a background check on them?
Also, get a bunch of quotes.
And book an appointment for, say, Tuesday?
You can't expect your neighbors to do everything HomeAdvisor can. So to find and book a top-rated home pro for free, just ask HomeAdvisor.
Hello. Let's go for a ride on a Peloton.
Let's go grab a couple thousand friends and chase each other up a hill. Let's go make a personal best, then beat it with your personal better than best. Let's go bring the world's best instructors right to you. Better yet, let's go bring the entire New York studio live. Let's go anytime, anywhere, with anyone who's willing. And let's go do it all right here. Ready to go? Peloton.
I have been diagnosed as stage 4 prostate cancer. When I met my team at CTCA, they put together a comprehensive plan that gave me an opportunity to accomplish my goals and my dreams.
Learn more at cancercenter.com.
Sunday, the calm before the storm. Anthony Bourdain in Puerto Rico, right before Hurricane Maria.
What will happen to this beautiful place?
All new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico, Sunday at 9 on CNN.
For Commonwealth Court, only one judge grew up in poverty, Ellen Seisler. Only one judge prosecuted violent criminals, Ellen Seisler. Endorsed by police, firefighters, and teachers, Ellen Seisler.
After 8 years of Chris Christie, is Kim Guadagno the change New Jersey really needs? Guadagno is Christie's hand-picked successor, says she's proud to be part of the Christie administration. Guadagno was Chris Christie's right hand as our schools came under attack. Critical services were underfunded, and our credit rating was downgraded 11 times. From the bridge to the beach, we've seen it all, and we've had enough. Kim Guadagno isn't the change we need.
For Commonwealth Court, only one judge grew up in poverty, Ellen Seisler. Only one judge prosecuted violent criminals, Ellen Seisler. Endorsed by police, firefighters, and teachers, Ellen Seisler.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Let's get back to our analysts. And David Axelrod, I want to play a little clip from an interview the president gave to Fox's Laura Ingraham last night. Listen to this exchange.
You're heading off to Asia, huge trip,
yeah.
Lots of stakes. You got North Korea, a deal with the Chinese, you're going to stop in Seoul. Your State Department still has some unfilled positions. Are you worried that the State Department doesn't have enough Donald Trump nominees in there to push your vision through? Because other State Departments, including Reagan's at times, undermined his agenda. And there is a concern that the State Department currently is undermining your agenda.
So we don't need all the people that they want. You know, don't forget, I'm a business person and I tell my people, well, you don't need to fill slots, don't fill them. But we have some people that I'm not happy with their
thinking process. But Assistant Secretary of State, you're not getting rid of that position.
But let me tell you, the one that matters is me. I'm the only one that matters.
So what do you think, David, about that statement? The one that matters is me. I'm the only one that matters. What impact does that have on American diplomacy?
Well, first of all, I think it may be a statement of philosophy for the entire administration, which is part of the problem that the president has, because he seems to feel that the only thing that matters is him. But I think the most serious implication of that particular statement, other than the lack of recognition that the understaffed State Department actually hobbles the ability of the United States to do its work around the world, is that it really undercuts the Secretary of State. And he's done it a couple of times. I mean, I honestly don't know how Rex Tillerson continues in that job, because the president cuts him off at the knees time and again. And here they are off on a journey to Asia that is of some consequence. And basically what he's saying is none of these guys count. And by implication, even the Secretary of State, I'm the one who matters. And I think it really makes it hard for people who are traveling and representing this country to do the job that we would hope they could do.
What do you think, Phil?
I think this is curious, sort of a head scratcher. You would think the president wants to revolutionize government, as he says, drain the swamp. One way to do that, as David's suggesting, classic way in government, is to put people in significant positions so that they can execute the policy that you want, particularly when they're faced with bureaucrats like me who might want to resist. This is an opportunity for him to drain the swamp, to execute policies he wants in places like the Middle East, against ISIS, regarding China, on North Korea. And yet he's saying policy only comes from me. This limits his ability to do what he wants. I don't understand it.
Do you understand it, Ron?
There's no evidence that policy fundamentally comes from him, right? I mean, the to begin with, right? In the sense that we have seen, I think, consistently through this presidency, that he operates in an orbit that is somewhat distinct from the policy orbit, both in the administration and on Capitol Hill. I mean, what the president does, by and large, in his public communication, is precipitate an endless series of personal feuds on Twitter, outrageous comments, suggestions of the kind we're talking about today. Meanwhile, there's a poll out today, again, that 60% of the public thinks the GOP tax plan is tilted toward the rich. Only less than 25% of the public supported the GOP repeal and replace ACA plans by the end. The president has shown he can dominate the news cycle. He hasn't shown he can move public opinion on an issue that matters, and that's what Congress needs more than anything else. So the idea that he is kind of, yes, he has certain predilections, but the idea that he is driving the policy in detail seems to me somewhat detached from where we are.
Susan, last night the president's Twitter account went down for 11 minutes. People had a lot of fun with that. It came back. There you see what they saw during those 11 minutes. But there are some national security concerns. If some employee can randomly shut down that account, could some random employee also post statements in the name of the president that could cause some sort of turmoil internationally?
Right. So there's been concerns about sort of the president's use both of unsecure cell phones and sort of, Twitter and social media as these direct communications. Imagine the kind of mischief that you could get into. Markets respond to what the president tweets. Imagine if someone hacked President Trump's account and instead of deleting it said, I've ordered a preemptive strike on North Korea. Right. These could have really, really profound consequences. And it appears as though the president hasn't necessarily sought or followed the advice of professionals at NSA and elsewhere regarding sort of what information security practices. It also sort of reveals that, Twitter is not the U.S. government. It's not focused on this sort of high-level security issue. It's a social media company. And so I really do think it's a pretty dramatic illustration of a potentially, really significant national security vulnerability. Yeah,
potentially very significant indeed. David Oxrell, let me get your thoughts on one other issue that came up today. The White House, the Trump administration, released its annual national climate assessment. Let me read a couple sentences. It is extremely likely that human influence has been the dominant cause of the observed warming since the mid-20th century. For the warming over the last century, there is no convincing alternative explanation supported by the extent of the observational evidence. Are you surprised by this statement coming in from the White House?
Well, look, it's a fair question because the president has called climate change a hoax in the past. His secretary of energy has doubted whether man is playing a role in climate change. His environmental director has been systematically dismantling programs. We withdrew from the planet, from the climate change agreement, the Paris climate change agreement. So this arrives as, to borrow a phrase, an inconvenient truth. But I really think they had no choice. First of all, it was mandated to release the report. Secondly, hundreds of scientists worked on this report. Ooh. The idea that you could suppress this report and it wouldn't be made public it would have been really, really foolish. And finally, as Ron points out, they're in the middle of a tax cut fight, and some rational person in the White House may have suggested, you know what, maybe we should skip this fight that we're not going to win anyway and try and concentrate on the things that we need to get done in the next couple of months.
Very quickly, Ron, give me your thought.
Yeah, look, I mean, I think that the collision between their agenda and the science and the observed reality that Americans are living through, climate change is not something anymore that people are thinking about affecting their kids or the 2045. They are looking at the pattern of hurricanes that are more intense than in the past. They're looking at the wildfires in California. You are seeing public opinion move. And I think the administration is caught in a position of, in effect, defending the past against what is an undeniable future.
All right, everybody stand by because there's more news coming into the Situation Room right now. Kim Jong-un may be getting ready for a new missile or another nuclear test, but he's also showing his softer side as well as he tours a cosmetics factory with his stylish wife. We have some fascinating photos we'll share with you.
Everybody knows smoking is bad for you. But what you might not know is that sitting all day at your desk may be just as bad. It may lead to heart disease and back pain. But standing more and sitting less is better for you. It decreases back pain and increases circulation. That's why there's Varidesk, the sit-stand solution that helps people feel better and get more done. It's crafted to last a lifetime and comes fully assembled, ready to work. Get yours at Varidesk.com.
You might take something for your heart or joints, but do you take something for your brain? With an ingredient originally found in jellyfish, Prevagen is the number one selling brain health supplement in drugstores nationwide. Prevagen, the name to remember.
When you're looking for answers, it's good to have help, because the right information at the right time may make all the difference. At Humana, we know that's especially true when you're looking for a Medicare supplement insurance plan. That's why we're offering this fact-filled guide, 7 Things Every Medicare Supplement Should Have. And it's yours free, just for calling 1-888-311-3547. You see, Medicare covers only about 80% of your Part B medical expenses. The rest is up to you. That's why so many people purchase Medicare supplement insurance plans like those offered by Humana. They're designed to help you save money and pay some of the costs Medicare doesn't. Depending on the Medicare supplement plan you select, you could have no deductibles or co-payments for doctor visits, hospital stays, emergency care, and more. You can keep the doctors you have now, ones you know and trust, with no referrals needed. Plus, you can get medical care anywhere in the country, even when you're traveling. With Humana, you get a competitive monthly premium and personalized service from a healthcare partner working to make healthcare simpler and easier for you. You can choose from a wide range of standardized plans. Each one is designed to work seamlessly with Medicare and help save you money. So how do you find the plan that's right for you? One that fits your needs and your budget? Call Humana now at 1-888-311-3547. That's 1-888-311-3547. Agent producer can answer any questions you have and help you choose the plan that's right for you. The call is free and there's no obligation. You know Medicare won't cover all your medical costs, so call now and see why a Medicare supplement plan from a company like Humana just might be the answer.
It can detect a threat using AI and respond 60 times faster. It lets you know where your data lives down to the very server. It keeps your insights from prying eyes so they're used by no one else but you. It is the cloud. The IBM cloud. The cloud that's designed for your data. AI ready. Secure to the core. The IBM cloud is the cloud for business. Yours.
The president vents about the DOJ and the FBI.
A lot of people are disappointed in the Justice Department, including me.
Just days after Russia probe indictments, is the president abusing his power? Aaron Burnett out front, live next.
Montgomery County's own Paul Lally is our highly qualified candidate for Commonwealth Court. An experienced litigator, Paul Lally fought successfully to protect the rights of homeowners and to ensure that our schools were adequately funded. Paul Lally has received the highest recommendation from the ACBA, and he stands for our country and our Constitution. On November 7th, vote Montgomery County's own Paul Lally for Commonwealth Court.
If you're hungry and want some good home cooking, Andy's Diner is the place to go. We feature all fresh ingredients, cooked to order, and we're open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All entrees come with our famous salad bar and a selection of homemade soups. Our weekend breakfast buffet features a special station that will prepare your omelet to order. We are a family-friendly business run by an old-world Greek family, which means fresh quality food at reasonable prices. We have 3 locations in Springhouse, Trevose, and Conshohocken. Andy's Diner. Come hungry. We love to serve you.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
We're standing by for President Trump's arrival in Hawaii as he begins a trip that will take him to the Korean Peninsula. Right now, I want to take a closer look at some rather unusual photos of the North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un with his wife. CNN's Brian Todd is here in the Situation Room. So, Brian, what does all this signify?
Wolf, one analyst believes that the presence of Kim Jong-un's wife, Ri Sol-ju, on the public stage means that there's some stability inside the regime right now. Tonight, we have new information on Kim's wife, on her powerful connections, and on the mysteries surrounding the couple's children. At the same time, North Korea's Kim Jong-un is flexing his muscles on the world stage, possibly, according to South Korean intelligence, preparing for another missile test. The reclusive, brutal dictator appears to be trying to soften his image at home. These newly released photos show a scene straight out of a Western democracy. The 33-year-old leader touring a cosmetics factory with his glamorous wife. North Korea's rarely seen first lady, Ri Sol-ju, is believed to be about 3 years younger than her husband. In the photos, she's dressed stylishly, examining bottles on the production line. But tonight, analysts see something more in these pictures, a trip to a makeup factory intended to dress up Kim Jong-un's image.
This would be an indication that there is stability inside the regime, that Kim is feeling comfortable with the people around him. Because when there are times of tension, either severe external tension or internal tension, she is usually not available.
Ri Sol-ju is said to be very image and fashion conscious. Former NBA star Dennis Rodman, after a visit with Kim and Ri, said North Korea's first lady often wears outfits from top designers. The regime is said to want to portray her as a Princess Diana-like figure, which analysts say serves as a critical balance.
Ri Sol-ju allows Kim to present a softer side of the regime to the outside world. And what she provides is this glamorous counterpart to the current narrative about North Korea as a human rights violator and developing illegal nuclear weapons.
Ri Sol-ju comes from Kim's inner circle of trusted elites. Former Air Force General Ri Pyong-chol, one of three top officials who Kim Jong-un often hugs after successful missile launches, is believed to be her grandfather or great uncle. Analysts say Kim Jong-un was set up with his future wife by the uncle he later executed, Jang Song-taek, and by the uncle's influential wife. Ri is also someone not unfamiliar with the spotlight.
From what we understand, she was an entertainer with one of the singing groups. She was also one of a group of cheerleaders who visited South Korea, we believe, in 2005.
Tonight, much of the intrigue surrounding this young couple has to do with questions about an heir apparent. Ri and Kim Jong-un are believed to have at least one child, a daughter, Kim Ju-ae, likely born a few years ago. Rodman claimed to have once held the child in his arms. Observers say the question of succession is critical.
She probably does feel some pressure, given that all three Kims have been leaders of North Korea have been male. So she probably does feel some pressure to produce a male heir.
But if Ri Sol-ju does not have a son, could Kim's daughter someday be elevated to be the supreme leader? Analysts are split on that. Some believe the North Koreans would be reluctant to place a woman in that position. But others say with this regime, bloodline is paramount, and a daughter would be more likely to assume leadership than anyone outside the Kim family. Wolf?
Lots of mysteries that continue to this day. Brian Todd reporting for us with that report. Brian, thank you very, very much. That's it for me. Thanks very much for watching. I'm Wolf Blitzer in the Situation Room. Aaron Burnett out front starts right now.
Out front next, President Trump says he can't remember. So what happened to that self-proclaimed greatest memory of all time? Plus, the president now calling on the Justice Department to go after his political enemies. Did he go too far? And the surprising sentence for Bo Bergdahl, no prison time. Did Trump's attacks on Bergdahl influence the judge's decision? Let's go out front. Good evening, everyone. I'm Kate Baldwin, in for Aaron Burnett. Out front tonight, I can't remember, or more like I want to forget. President Trump insisting he can't recall a campaign meeting during the election when foreign policy advisor George Papadopoulos floated the idea of setting up a visit between Trump and Russian President Vladimir Putin. Here's President Trump earlier today.
I don't remember much about that meeting. It was a very unimportant meeting, took place for a long time. Don't remember much about it.
That may be so, but why then did President Trump also make this bold claim just last week?
I'm a very intelligent person, one of the great memories of all time.
To make matters worse for the president, another campaign advisor remembers the meetings quite well. J.D. Gordon telling CNN that Trump, quote, heard him, meaning Papadopoulos, heard him out. And it seems the president isn't the only one in this administration who's having a hard time remembering any potentially damaging information about Russia. Attorney General Jeff Sessions also has a case of the I can't remembers when it comes to this same meeting and another one. And that's just this week. Don't forget, from Jared Kushner to Donald Trump Jr. to Michael Flynn, they've also had trouble remembering pretty much anything having to do with the Russians. So, what's going on with Russian amnesia? Jessica Schneider's out front tonight. So, Jessica, the list keeps growing.
It does, Kate. The I can't remember, it seems to be a common refrain. As you heard there, the president said it today when asked about that March 2016 meeting he was at when George Papadopoulos proposed that Trump meet with Russian President Vladimir Putin. And then there's Attorney General Jeff Sessions. He was in that meeting too. And while we haven't seen him respond directly to this yet, Democrats are now accusing him of everything from problems telling the truth to perjury for prior statements.
Tonight, the president remains defiant amid mounting evidence that he knew about his campaign advisor's connections to Russia.
There was no collusion. There was no nothing.
In February of this year, he pleaded total ignorance.
Can you say whether you are aware that anyone who advised your campaign had contacts with Russia during the course of the election?
Well, I told you, General Flynn obviously was dealing, so that's one person, but he was dealing as he should have been.
During the election?
No, nobody that I know of. Nobody.
So you're not aware of any contacts during the course of the election?
How many times do I have to answer this question?
Can you just say
Russia
yes or no
is
on
a
it?
Ruse. I have nothing to do with Russia. To the best of my knowledge, no person that I deal with does. Now, Manafort has totally denied it.
Tonight, Paul Manafort and Rick Gates remain under house arrest. The indictment against them was unsealed Monday for money laundering and failing to register as foreign agents. Manafort and Gates have pleaded not guilty to the charges, which stem from their work as lobbyists for a pro-Russian Ukrainian political party and was not explicitly related to their work during the campaign. And now Attorney General Jeff Sessions is also coming under increasing fire for answers he gave at several congressional hearings over the past year.
You don't believe that surrogates from the Trump campaign had communications with the Russians. Is that what you're saying?
I did not, and I'm not aware of anyone else that did. And I don't believe it happened.
I think it's not that he has a problem with the truth. I think it's easier to say that he's perjured himself at least three times.
A bit of background.
The accusations from Democrats come after revelations from former campaign foreign policy advisors Carter Page and George Papadopoulos. Carter Page telling CNN that he told congressional investigators he mentioned to Sessions a trip he planned to take to Russia at the height of the campaign. And in a March 2016 meeting where Papadopoulos sat in between then-candidate Trump and Jeff Sessions, court documents show Papadopoulos told the group he had connections that could help arrange a meeting between then-candidate Trump and President Putin. Campaign advisor J.D. Gordon, sitting next to Papadopoulos, tells CNN Donald Trump heard him out, but then-Senator Sessions, who was a top campaign surrogate, shot down the idea of a meeting with Putin, a source tells CNN.
The next president will have to fashion a strategy in keeping with America's traditions.
This is video of Papadopoulos speaking at an event unrelated to the campaign in 2016. President Trump has downplayed his role, calling him a low-level volunteer and a liar. But Papadopoulos' disclosures to the FBI as part of his guilty plea for lying about his contacts with Russians during the campaign are already affecting the administration.
For example, Sam Clovis was forced to withdraw his name from a top spot at the Department of Agriculture after the Washington Post revealed he was the campaign supervisor referred to in court documents, where emails show that Clovis encouraged Papadopoulos to set up a meeting in Russia. Now, Clovis told the president in that withdrawal letter that he was withdrawing so he wouldn't be a distraction in what he called a heightened political climate. Kate?
That isn't going to be wearing down anytime soon. Great to see you, Jessica. Thank you so much. Out front tonight, Evan Perez, CNN Justice correspondent, Nia Malika Henderson, senior political reporter, and Paul Krieger, former assistant U.S. attorney. Great to see you all. So, Evan, is it possible that they simply don't remember any of these conversations about meetings with Russians? What are you hearing?
Well, you know, look, it is possible. If you remember the Trump campaign, it was sort of an insurgent operation. It was rejected by the establishment. And, you know, you had a bunch of characters that who, you know, were sort of like on the fringe, who Donald Trump brought in to sort of be his national security team, who had been rejected by some of the other candidates. So it is possible that these people just didn't know each other, and maybe this doesn't really spring to mind. But it does seem to be a pattern. And I think that's one reason why so many people have so many questions. And we know that Robert Mueller, the special counsel, is doing an investigation here. So he's got emails, he's got records that perhaps we'll check to see whether any of this checks out, and we'll see.
And if at the same time, they're either They're either low-level volunteer kind of nobodies, or they're
everybody was a volunteer, though. In that campaign, everybody was a volunteer.
That's exactly right. Or even if they are a volunteer, they're a foreign policy advisor. These all can't be true at the same time. But try this one on for size as well, Nia. I mean, I want to play for you again what the president said about that meeting today and also what he said just last week.
I don't remember much about that meeting. It was a very unimportant meeting. Took place a long time. Don't remember much about it. One of the great memories of all time.
I mean, can both of these things be true, Nia?
No, I mean, they can't be. I mean, he sort of says two things even in that statement, that he doesn't remember it, but he remembers it enough to say that it was unimportant, right? So, I mean, that in and of itself is a bit of a contradiction. We have seen this sort of Russia-induced amnesia from a lot of people in Trump's orbit, whether it's Sessions, whether it's Michael Flynn not remembering the details of a conversation that he had with the then-Russian ambassador Kissinger. Even Papadopoulos seemed to not quite remember the timeline, and that, of course, got him in trouble with the FBI. Donald Trump Jr. Didn't quite remember the details of a meeting he had with a Russian lawyer. So, you know, this is the pattern. That, of course, is what Bob Mueller will look at. He will, of course, have documents. He will have maybe witnesses who can contradict this kind of memory or different statements that other witnesses make. But I think, you know, this is what we've seen from this White House, from people around this White House, this idea of they can't remember, they can't quite recall, which is something. I mean, you know, I'm no lawyer. I don't play one on TV. I've watched a lot of Law and Order. Oftentimes, you do hear witnesses sort of rely on that phrase that they can't quite recall, they don't remember as a sort of non-answer to questions.
Then let's go to the actual lawyer and plays one in real life and on TV. So, Paul, to Nia's point, the I don't remember is a tried and true legal defense that we've seen over and over again. I mean, in fact, Donald Trump used it himself in a deposition, I think it was in 2015, something over 30 times during his deposition. Also during that same deposition, Donald Trump said, and if you, like, I have amnesia because I have to say it again, he added this, I don't remember that. As good as my memory is, I don't remember that, but I have a good memory. How good of a legal defense is this?
Well, in a criminal case, if a charged individual is repeatedly claiming that they don't remember something that common sense would tell an average person based on the significance of the event is significant, that defense begins to crumble a little bit. In addition, if I were the prosecutor on this case, I'd be looking at emails, correspondence before and after the March 31st, 2016 meeting.
Because that's what's happening, right? I don't remember, especially with Papadopoulos. He doesn't remember or has a faulty memory. Then the emails show what exactly a kind of a better chain of timeline. And then he had to plead guilty.
Right. I mean, it's interesting in this case. What you're not hearing is people saying that George Papadopoulos is lying about this meeting or the events didn't happen. J.D. Gordon, who was a campaign advisor, actually corroborated Mr. Papadopoulos and saying basically exactly what was Mr. Papadopoulos was charged with.
So there's that. And Evan, when it comes to Attorney General Jeff Sessions, let's just narrow in on that and what he can't remember. That's piling up. Do you think he's in trouble?
Well, you know, I think there's enough caveats in what Jeff Sessions says. If you look at all of the testimonies that he's given, and he's under oath, obviously, he does sort of have these caveats that I think will make him be able to escape any accusations that he purposely lied to any of those committees. Look, mm-hmm. I think they are going to bring him back, though, and they're going to make him explain himself. And this, in the end, is going to be a political problem for him that's going to keep piling up. And that's, in of itself, like a big problem. But I will say, you know, just looking at what Papadopoulos did, I think what you get a picture there is that, you know, the special counsel has information, and he chose in those documents that were released earlier this week, he only revealed certain parts of it. For instance,
right.
he says something about how, you know, Papadopoulos brought up the Russia meeting between Putin and Trump. But we know there's more to that, and they purposely did not put the rest of that interaction in there. And so we'll see whether other witnesses will lie when they are questioned about it.
And intriguing, on the whole, the fact that he thought he was going to be getting dirt in those Hillary
right.
Clinton emails, there's no follow-up on who, if he told anyone
right.
with the campaign. So that's one of those huge caveats where
very
you have to say,
right.
yeah, there's got to be more to that. I mean, Paul, when it comes to Jeff Sessions, we have one of the Democratic congressmen said that he thinks at this point Sessions very clearly, in his view, perjured himself. Do you think it's reached that point?
Well, perjury, to prove perjury, you have to show that at the time the person made the statements, they knew they were false.
Okay.
So clearly there are some inconsistencies here, and that's exactly why Jeff Sessions has to go back before Congress and explain those inconsistencies.
And even if it comes to perjury, what exactly does that mean? I mean, Nia, Democrats want him back on the Hill for questioning, but he's already recused himself from anything related to Russia. So what are they going for now? Do they just want to, I don't know, take him down?
I don't know if it's taken down. I think it's sort of more of a political move. I mean, Democrats did originally not like Jeff Sessions. You've heard
right.
from some Democrats even call for his resignation, Kamala Harris, for instance. But at this point, you wonder if Democrats could be playing into this idea that maybe Jeff Sessions will be fired by Donald Trump, right, who also has had problems with Jeff Sessions because he recused himself from the Russia investigation. So, you know, are they giving sort of ammunition and reason to Donald Trump to maybe let Sessions go, bring in another attorney general who then would have the sort of authority to be to fire Mueller if he wanted to be? I mean, I'm sort of just playing this out. I mean, mm-hmm. I think Democrats for now sort of just want to make a point of having Jeff Sessions have to explain himself again and have Russia back in the headlines and Sessions sort of involvement with it and not being truthful in terms of his original testimony around Russia. But who knows what this could trigger in terms of the president's thinking about this, the president's thinking about Jeff Sessions, his role, and Mueller's role.
Yeah, I mean, I think the only one thing that we know is, like, who knows? Because look right. where we began yeah. and where we are now.
Right. Yeah.
We're right. leaving it right there. Wait for next week.
Exactly.
Do I need to remind you where we started on Monday? Okay,
yeah.
Great to have you guys. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Out front next, breaking news. President Trump just landing in Hawaii as he heads off on his trip to Asia. This as he is calling on the Justice Department to go after his enemies. Did he finally cross a line here? Plus, a stunning decision. Bo Bergdahl avoids prison for deserting his army post in Afghanistan. Did the president's words play a part in the decision? And a Las Vegas shooting victim with life-threatening injuries. We're going to show you her miraculous recovery 1 month after that horrific night.
Aaron Burnett Out Front, brought to you by Otesla. Learn more at otesla.com.
If you have moderate to severe plaque psoriasis, isn't it time to let the real you shine through? Maybe it's time for Otesla, apremilast. Otesla is not an injection or a cream. It's a pill that treats plaque psoriasis differently. With Otesla, 75% clearer skin is achievable after just 4 months, with reduced redness, thickness, and scaliness of plaques. And the Otesla prescribing information has no requirement for routine lab monitoring. Don't use if you're allergic to Otesla. Otesla may cause severe diarrhea, nausea, or vomiting. Tell your doctor if these occur. Otesla is associated with an increased risk of depression. Tell your doctor if you have a history of depression or suicidal thoughts, or if these feelings develop. Some people taking Otesla reported weight loss. Your doctor should monitor your weight and may stop treatment. Other side effects include upper respiratory tract infection and headache. Tell your doctor about all the medicines you take and if you're pregnant or planning to be. Ask your dermatologist about Otesla today. Otesla, show more of you.
My job? Create a workplace that provides great experiences and builds value.
That takes an accomplished HR team with the latest skills and know-how. And nothing spells that more clearly than SHRM CP and SHRM SCP.
SHRM's competency-based certifications say HR professionals are ready to build business success and shape the changing world of work.
I'm confident when I know an HR professional is SHRM certified.
Accredited SHRM certifications are the key to great HR.
And great HR makes great organizations.
We're on a mission to show drip coffee drinkers it's time to wake up to Keurig.
Wakey, wakey, rise and shine!
How are you?
Well, watch this. I pop that in there, press brew, that's it.
So rich.
I love it.
That's why you should be a Keurig man!
Full-bodied.
Are you sure you're describing the coffee and not me?
Don't get in my way.
People come here to change the story of their lives. I imagined a story where I didn't have to make the damsel.
It's time for the Sleep Number semi-annual sale on the only bed that adjusts on both sides to your ideal comfort, your Sleep Number setting. And snoring? Does your bed do that? Right now, during our semi-annual sale, our Queen C4 mattress with adjustable comfort on both sides is only $14.99. Save $300. And
with my moderate to severe Crohn's disease, I kept looking for ways to manage my symptoms. I thought I was doing okay. Then it hit me. Managing was all I was doing. When I told my doctor, I learned Humira is for people who still have symptoms of moderate to severe Crohn's disease, even after trying other medications. In clinical studies, the majority of people on Humira saw significant symptom relief, and many achieved remission.
Humira can lower your ability to fight infections, including tuberculosis. Serious, sometimes fatal infections and cancers, including lymphoma, have happened. Thus have blood, liver, and nervous system problems, serious allergic reactions, and new or worsening heart failure. Before treatment, get tested for TB. Tell your doctor if you've been to areas where certain fungal infections are common, and if you've had TB, hepatitis B, are prone to infections, or have flu-like symptoms or sores. Don't start Humira if you have an infection.
Just managing your symptoms? Ask your gastroenterologist about Humira. With Humira, remission is possible.
Breaking news, President Trump just walking off Air Force One just now in Hawaii as he is basically, we can think of this as a brief pit stop as he heads off on his big Asia region trip. He'll be hitting up 5 countries, 12 days, a huge foreign policy issues at stake. And President Trump stopping right now in Honolulu. He'll be there tomorrow and then heads off to Tokyo. The other breaking news, though, we are watching tonight. A top Republican senator calling out President Trump for pressuring his Justice Department to go after his political enemies. Senator Bob Corker, who, of course, has become one of the most vocal Trump critics of late, saying this tonight in a statement. The president's comments are, quote, totally inappropriate and not only undermine our justice system, but erode the American people's confidence in our institutions. What led to that? Well, quite a bit, starting earlier today when Trump tweeted this. Everybody is asking why the Justice Department and FBI isn't looking into all of the dishonesty going on with crooked Hillary and the Dems. And then Trump said this.
I'm really not involved with the Justice Department. I'd like to let it run itself. But honestly, they should be looking at the Democrats. They should be looking at Podesta and all of that dishonesty. They should be looking at a lot of things. And a lot of people are disappointed in the Justice Department, including me.
Out front now, Walter Schaub, the former director of the Office of Government Ethics, and CNN's chief legal analyst, Jeffrey Toobin. All right, Jeffrey, let's get to it. This wasn't, it also just wasn't a one-off today. The President Trump said basically the same last night. Listen to this.
Thing is that because I'm the President of the United States, I am not supposed to be involved with the Justice Department. I'm not supposed to be involved with the FBI. I'm not supposed to be doing the kind of things that I would love to be doing. And I'm very frustrated by it.
He says he's sad that he can't get involved. Him saying that, isn't that inherently getting involved?
Well, of course it is. And remember why these norms exist. You know, Richard Nixon tried to use the Justice Department to punish his political enemies, use the Internal Revenue Service to punish his political enemies. And there are established rules that were followed by presidents of both parties that law enforcement is something that the president does not get involved in on individual cases, especially when it involves his political opponents.
Exactly.
Because this is the kind of country we are where the president doesn't get to put his political opponents in prison. But if you listen to what the president said yesterday and what he wrote, what he's saying is he's frustrated that the Justice Department is not putting the woman he ran against for president in prison. And that's the kind of thing that happens in authoritarian countries, not in the United States. So, you know, I know we sort of get overloaded with like, oh, Trump said this, Trump said another thing, he tweeted this. This is something that is so far outside the mainstream of American law and politics. It's just really remarkable.
And very much not the first time he's questioned the judicial system. I mean, and Walter, you were in charge of the Office of Government Ethics. The president is calling on the Justice Department to go after his political enemies. I mean, from your perspective, should this raise red flags?
Well, Jeffrey's right. This is the stuff that authoritarianism is made of, and it's just absolutely terrifying. It's simply the scariest thing that I've seen happen so far in this administration. He just simply seems to have no appreciation for or interest in the importance of the independence of the Department of Justice. And it's just been a consistent assault on our justice system, from him calling it a laughingstock, to him attacking judges, to him firing the head of the FBI, implying that he might be willing to fire the head of the Department of Justice for not going after his political opponents. You're just simply not, in a free society, supposed to use the apparatus of the state to go after your political rivals.
And remember, you know, Jeff Sessions, the attorney general, is already hanging by a thread with Trump. I mean, he already has said many times how dissatisfied he is. And now he's, in effect, instructing Sessions to start going after his enemies.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. Do you think that this is a threat, an ultimatum? Sessions, do this or else?
I mean, I don't know how else to interpret it. I mean, he says, well, I can't tell the Department of Justice what to do, but here's what I think the Department of Justice should do, and I'm very disappointed and may fire the attorney general. I mean, how else can you interpret
you
what
know,
he said?
Walter, this also had me thinking today that this is the very same Donald Trump that this is the very same Donald Trump, along with, let's say, every other Republican, who lit their hair on fire when Bill Clinton met with the former AG Loretta Lynch on a tarmac. Just to remind everyone, listen.
Bill Clinton goes in the other day into an airplane. Just happened to be, just a coincidence, you know. He just happened to be at the airport at this time. You know, he's talking about golf and grandchildren. I love my grandchildren so much. But if I talk about him for more than about 9 or 10 seconds, you know, what do we?
He called it a disgrace, a violation of the rule of law. I mean, it was a major misstep then. Everyone agreed on that. How is all this from Trump to be received then over the Justice Department?
Well, look, we are so far beyond hypocrisy. This is the White House that is using private emails after Channing locked her up for using private emails. There's no two ways about it that what Bill Clinton did was dumb and it was wrong.
Right.
But he was a former president of the United States, and we don't know what was said on that plane. The fear and what Trump was implying was that he was somehow trying to get her to back off of investigating his wife. Well, now what we have is an actual president of the United States actually saying, go after my rivals. So we don't have to speculate or wonder. And so this is just the height of hypocrisy right now.
I really do wonder, though, Jeffrey, how is this received over at Justice? This isn't the first time. Like,
well, you know, I used to be an assistant U.S. attorney, which is, of course, a very low level, but a very responsible job. And, you know, one of the things that everyone at the Department of Justice feels great pride in is that it is an apolitical institution, other than at the very top levels where there are policy issues about sentencing and about, you know, voting rights.
Yeah.
But when it comes to criminal prosecution, those are issues left outside the political process. And to see a president, you know, wink, wink, nod, nod, telling the attorney general whom to prosecute, It's just not right. And you know, we expect new presidents to change policies, but we don't expect new presidents to change the norms, to change the rules of the game. And that's what President Trump is doing here.
I am still trying to find the upside. I'm trying to find the upside on this for Trump. But
his base loves it.
I guess
the people who are chanting lock her up, want her locked up.
But it's still a Justice Department, his Justice Department, that he's slamming at every turn on this and how they prosecute terror cases and on and on. How this helps him. Let's leave it for another day. Great to see you guys. Thank you so much. Out front next. Did President Trump's own words lead to the controversial sentencing of Bo Bergdahl? And the president claims he is hitting ISIS much harder as revenge for the New York City terror attack. Except, where is the evidence of that?
When I grow up, I want to be in a garden for the whole world. There will be flowers, vegetables, fruit, and even lima beans.
We all grow up, but I didn't give up on dreaming big. Here at Coke, my team and I push each other to find new natural ways to feed a growing world. You know, it's a serious challenge, but I've been preparing my whole life.
So, that goal you've been saving for, you can do it.
We can do this.
At Fidelity, our online planning tools are clear and straightforward, so you can plan for retirement while saving for the things you want to do today.
Labor hates him. Civil rights leaders hate him. All the liberals hate him.
We can aspire to something greater.
You're out of your damn mind.
I need people like me. Shut the door.
LBJ. Rated R. Now playing.
I want you to take it easy. Go slow.
Come on, Mom.
Work, 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 Sonora. Work your body liner. Work, 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 Sonora. Work it all the time.
Let's go.
For the ones who keep pushing, always unstoppable.
Patrick woke up with a sore back, but he's got work to do. So he took a leave this morning. If he'd taken Tylenol, he'd be stopping for more pills right now. Only Aleve has the strength to stop tough pain for up to 12 hours with just one pill. Tylenol can't do that. Aleve. All day strong, all day long. Also try Aleve Direct Therapy with TENS technology for lower back pain relief.
Sunday, the calm before the storm. Anthony Bourdain in Puerto Rico, right before Hurricane Maria.
What will happen to this beautiful place?
All new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico, Sunday at 9 on CNN.
Montgomery County's own Paul Lally is our highly qualified candidate for Commonwealth Court. An experienced litigator, Paul Lally fought successfully to protect the rights of homeowners and to ensure that our schools were adequately funded. Paul Lally has received the highest recommendation from the ACBA, and he stands for our country and our Constitution. On November 7th, vote Montgomery County's own Paul Lally for Commonwealth Court.
We know our customers have busy lives, and that's why we're working hard to improve our customer service. The whole culture of the company is shifting towards customer service. Now with Xfinity My Account, you can pay your bill right from your phone and easily add premium channels. You can even change your Wi-Fi password to something that's easy to remember. We're doing everything we can to give you the best experience possible. I'm Kieran from Comcast. We should fit into your life, not the other way around.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
New tonight, President Trump angry that Bo Bergdahl will not be spending time anytime in prison. A military judge today announcing the ruling for the Army sergeant who had deserted his post in Afghanistan back in 2009. The president tweeting this: "The decision on Sergeant Bergdahl is a complete and total disgrace to our country and to our military." Bergdahl was captured and held hostage by the Taliban for 5 years. He came home as part of a controversial exchange for Guantanamo Bay detainees. Bergdahl pleaded guilty last month to desertion and misbehavior before the enemy. He originally faced life in prison, but prosecutors had asked the judge for a 14-year sentence. Today, the judge instead decided Bergdahl will be dishonorably discharged and fined $1,000 a month for the next 10 months. Nick Valencia is out front.
Bo Bergdahl walked into court on Friday at Fort Bragg, visibly tense. Just moments later, a military judge sentenced him to be dishonorably discharged, thereby avoiding jail time.
Sergeant Bergdahl has looked forward to today for a long time.
It was the culmination of a nearly 10-year saga for the 31-year-old, who just last month pled guilty to desertion and misbehaving in front of the enemy. It was June 30th, 2009, when Bergdahl deliberately walked away from his army post in Afghanistan. Within hours, he was captured by the Taliban and held hostage for almost 5 years. Bergdahl has said he spent most of that time living in a metal cage, barely big enough to stretch his legs, repeatedly beaten and tortured. Several servicemen were injured while looking for Bergdahl in Afghanistan, including Master Sergeant Mark Allen, who was shot in the head and left paralyzed. In 2014, Bergdahl was released in a controversial prisoner swap for five Guantanamo Bay detainees. And during the campaign, then-candidate Donald Trump blasted the decision and Bergdahl.
We're tired of Sergeant Bergdahl, who's a traitor, who should have been executed. 30 years ago, he would have been shot.
Today, President Trump slammed Bergdahl's sentence, tweeting, "The decision on Sergeant Bergdahl is a complete and total disgrace to our country and to our military." Bergdahl tearfully apologized Monday to the soldiers who searched for him, saying, "My words can't take away what people have been through. I'm admitting I made a horrible mistake. A mistake he'll have to live with for the rest of his life."
The conditions of Bergdahl's sentence will be taken effect immediately, with the exception of that dishonorable discharge. Eugene Fidel, the civilian attorney for Bergdahl, tells me that Bergdahl will remain in the Army until the appeals process is completely exhausted. Also, one point to note, the convening authority, the man who convened the court-martial on Bergdahl, General Robert Abrams, well, he has a chance to look at this sentence, and he also has the authority to lessen the charges against Bergdahl if he sees fit. Kate?
Nick Valencia, thanks so much, Nick. I appreciate it. Out front with me now, retired Army Major General James Spider Marks and former Republican Chair of the House Intelligence Committee and retired FBI Special Agent Mike Rogers. He also served in the Army. Great to see both of you. Congressman, first to you. When President Obama announced the deal to get Bergdahl home, you called it dangerous. What's your reaction tonight to the sentence?
Well, I'm very, very, very disappointed for a couple of reasons. One, you released five people, two of which, by the way, were believed to be at the site where a CIA officer, Michael Spann, was killed. One was a Taliban intelligence leader who we know slaughtered civilians all across Afghanistan and helped plan operations against U.S. troops. So those are two of the other ones were engaged in terrorist activities. So think of the effort level of effort to bring those folks to justice. They were traded for somebody who admitted he deserted. And in the following days of that, we had one individual sergeant who was shot in the head and is now disabled. We had other folks injured. And the judge could have gone life in prison. I don't think that was probably right. But no jail time? Absolutely no jail time? I think that's disrespectful to the men and women we ask to go on outside the wire every day and risk their lives. And certainly the men and women that serve with them believe that.
General, what do you think?
Yeah, my view of this is that Bergdahl did, in his admission of guilt of what he did, clearly there was an acknowledgement on his part that he didn't make a mistake. He consciously made a decision to desert, and then the other charge is misbehavior in the face of the enemy. And then as a result of those actions, I think what was in the mind of the judge, and Mike Rogers and I may disagree on this, but I can't get into the head of that judge. But I think what he's thinking is, look, Bergdahl gained no personal advantage by deserting. He deserted his post, he abandoned his troops, he put other soldiers at risk, and we all acknowledge that. But on a personal level, he gained no advantage, and he spent the next 5 years in a cage. And then he was released. And the terms of the release, I would agree with Mike, were egregious, because the condition, there were no conditions that were put upon their release. They went to Qatar, and if their life in Qatar had been miserable and if they were followed 24/7, I might be able to agree to that. But that certainly was not the case. So in this particular case, you've got a sergeant that's now going to be dishonorably discharged. He is going to have to live with this the rest of his life, gets no benefit. And well, he's going to have to find a community that's going to be able to embrace this type of individual who conducted these kinds of actions and abandoned his buddies. So it's a horrible thing all around. Yeah. There's absolutely zero sympathy for Bo Bergdahl on this.
But Congressman, the president tweeted about the sentencing right after it happened. The complete and total disgrace to our country and to our military. Do you think the president should be weighing in on this at all?
No, I don't. I mean, again, I one thing I'll give him credit for, he did talk about it in the campaign. He stopped talking about it as president. I'll give him credit for that, because in theory, he's in the chain of command of the individual who was in that court. And I would have thought that would have been beyond the pale. But he didn't do that. You know, afterward, he made a statement. And I hope what happens is we don't get distracted of what happened. And where I just disagree with my good friend Spider, desertion isn't about a personal thing anyway. You serve in a unit to protect the people on your left and your right. And so when you desert, it's more than a personal gain. You're causing harm and danger and risk to the people around you. That's why I think desertion is such a serious thing. And it wasn't just desertion on a post. This is desertion in a combat environment. And then subsequent to that, I mean, we worry about him having to worry about what he lived with. How about the sergeant who is disabled and can't get out of a wheelchair for the rest of his life? I just think some time in jail would have sent a message to our fellow soldiers. Well, we get it, and we understand your pain, and you're right. A deserter should never
that.
Be treated well.
Let me ask you about that. Because when Bergdahl came home, some of those who served with him and were sent out to search for him, they weren't just not happy. They were furious, and they were angry. Listen to this.
You would never leave to begin with without your equipment or your weapon. So that's suspect from the beginning. I don't believe he had any intention on coming back.
He violated his oath. He violated, you know, the Army values. He violated his general orders and the bond between brothers that exist on the battlefield.
So, General, do you think this sends a bad message to the troops?
Well, what it says is that, look, this is a human endeavor. I don't disagree at all with Mike in terms of how he described this and the definition of desertion. It's egregious. His two buddies that were just on air, those interviews that they had, totally embrace what they're saying and the risks that they had to put themselves and their buddies through in order to try to make this situation right, in order to try to recover. The presumption is that Bergdahl left for whatever reasons or might have been captured and taken away. So irrespective of intent, they went after to try to make a situation right. Mm-hmm. Look, this is all about the infallibility of our justice system and the infallibility of those that are involved in it. It is a horrible circumstance that we're about. We can disagree in many, many ways about what this result should look like, and we will for quite some time.
That's exactly right. Great to see both of you. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Out front next, Donald Trump claiming the United States is attacking ISIS big time now as payback for the New York City terror attack. Is that true? And women who say protesting Trump is not enough.
I know Donald Trump isn't central to your campaign at all, but he was part of the...
He inspired me.
He inspired you.
Absolutely.
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she had to buy lots of groceries. While she was shopping for organic fruits and veggies, burglars broke into her shoe. They stole her kids' mountain bikes and tablets along with her new juice press. Luckily, the Geico Insurance Agency had helped her with homeowner's insurance. She got full replacement on the stolen goods and started a mountain bike. Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. New TGI Friday's Big Ribs. Bigger, bolder, meatier. Just $12.99 for a full rack and two sides. Get it here or get it to go.
He's brought us to the brink of nuclear war. Accused of obstructing justice at the FBI and of violating the Constitution by taking money from foreign governments and threatening to shut down news organizations that report the truth. If that isn't a case for impeaching and removing a dangerous president, then what has our government become? I'm Tom Steyer, and like you, I'm a citizen who knows it's up to us to do something. It's why I'm funding this effort to raise our voices together and demand that Congress and his own administration know that this president is a clear and present danger, who's mentally unstable and armed with nuclear weapons, and they do nothing. Join us and tell your member of Congress that they have a moral responsibility to stop doing what's political and start doing what's right. Our country depends on it.
Today, big thinking in the Finger Lakes is pushing the new New York forward. We're the number one dairy and apple producers in the eastern United States. Supported by innovative packaging that extends the shelf life of foods and infrastructure upgrades that help us share our produce with the world. All across New York State, we're building the new New York. To grow your business with us in New York State, visit esd.ny.gov.
You don't have an issue sharing your husband?
People can have more than one soulmate.
I'll say it's crazy loving another man who's married.
Monogamy doesn't work for a lot of people.
This is Life with Lisa Lang, Sunday night at 10 on CNN.
Angry about Donald Trump? Trump would end health care for millions. On Tuesday, November 7th, you can fight back. Vote for judges to protect our rights. Send Trump a message. Vote for the Democrats.
Mr. Murphy, are there other taxes you would raise?
The answer is yes.
Higher income taxes, higher property taxes, higher business taxes, higher sales taxes, a plan to raise them all.
It's a ton of money.
If Goldman Sachs multimillionaire Phil Murphy gets elected, he'll be the only one who can afford to stay here. Kim Guadagno is better. Kim's plan finally cuts property taxes. Real relief for real families. A more affordable New Jersey. Kim Guadagno, better.
Angry about Donald Trump? Trump threatens our civil rights. On Tuesday, November 7th, you can fight back. Vote for judges to protect our rights. Send Trump a message. Vote for the Democrats.
Vote now for the CNN Hero of the Year at CNNHeroes.com and Facebook Messenger.
New tonight, President Trump claiming retaliation for the terror attack in New York City, announcing that in the aftermath, the military is striking ISIS harder than ever.
What we're doing is every time we're attacked from this point forward, and it took place yesterday, we are hitting them 10 times harder. So when we have an animal do an attack like he did the other day on the west side of Manhattan, we are hitting them 10 times harder.
Yet the administration has yet provided no evidence of that. Data provided by the Pentagon shows essentially no change in U.S. attacks on ISIS targets, and certainly not tenfold. Out front now, Bob Baer, former CIA operative and former Air Force Colonel Cedric Layton. Great to see both of you. Colonel, if the military is actually hitting ISIS 10 times harder now, wouldn't that be a huge escalation, and wouldn't we know about it?
Oh, I think we certainly would. I mean, there are enough correspondents out there, Kate, that would tell us that something is going on, and you would see basically instead of 13 or 10 sorties, you'd see anywhere from 100 to 130 sorties being flown against ISIS targets. And that is just not happening in ISIS-controlled areas of Syria or Iraq at this time.
Sure doesn't seem like it. I mean, Bob, so if the president is not telling the truth on this here, what impact does a threat, if that's only what it is, what kind of an impact does that have on ISIS? Does it make them rethink an attack, or the opposite?
Oh, not at all, Kate. I mean, you know, clearly he's exaggerating. Central Command has said same number of attacks have occurred afterwards. And it's not to mention that the Air Force has run out of targets. I mean, with Raqqa falling, Deir ez-Zor falling, they're just there's nothing to hit anymore, really. They're hiding among civilians in parts of Syria. So, I mean, it's the president's credibility we're talking about here, and you really have to wonder when his military contradicts him. The Central Command has said nothing about this, so you really have to know what's going on, and it's certainly not going to deter the Islamic State from encouraging lone wolves to hit in the United States. This will continue just the same.
Because remember, the latest word is that this was an ISIS-inspired attack. And Colonel, one thing that is different about what happened with the terror attack here in New York City is oftentimes ISIS does not claim responsibility when the attacker isn't killed in the act. This time, the suspect didn't die, of course. He's in custody, but ISIS is still claiming he's one of them. Do you think that signals something's changed?
I do, Kate, and the reason I think that is because ISIS is basically cornered. As Bob was mentioning, we're running out of targets, and ISIS has a lot less territory that they are basically controlling right now. And as a result, any type of attack that is done in their name is going to be an attack that they're going to take credit for. And that's why we're seeing them claiming credit for the New York attack, and we can expect them to do that, I think, going forward.
Bob, what do you think?
I totally agree. I mean, the organization is gone. There is no caliphate. You know, it's a couple weeks from now, it's going to be completely gone. It has no credibility. And anybody that conducts violence in the West in the name of Islam, they're going to claim it one way or another. And, you know, it's a dead-end movement. I just agree totally.
Well, that is a big moment for President Trump, though he says still they're going to be hitting him 10 times harder. Let's see what happens next. Thanks, gentlemen. Out front for us next, women motivated by Donald Trump. Why? Plus, a concert goer shot in the eye during the Las Vegas massacre. Tonight, the details of Tina Frost's incredible recovery.
When you have type 2 diabetes, you manage your A1C, but you also have a higher risk of heart attack or stroke. Non-insulin Victoza lowers A1C and now reduces cardiovascular risk.
Victoza lowers my A1C and blood sugar better than the leading branded pill.
And for people with type 2 diabetes treating cardiovascular disease, Victoza is now approved to lower the risk of major cardiovascular events such as heart attack, stroke, or death.
And while it isn't for weight loss, Victoza may help you lose some weight.
Victoza is not for people with type 1 diabetes or diabetic ketoacidosis. Do not take Victoza if you have a personal or family history of medullary thyroid cancer, multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome type 2, or if you are allergic to Victoza or any of its ingredients. Stop taking Victoza and get medical help right away if you get symptoms of a serious allergic reaction, such as rash, swelling, difficulty breathing or swallowing. Serious side effects may happen, including pancreatitis. So stop taking Victoza and call your doctor right away if you have severe pain in your stomach area. Tell your doctor your medical history. Gallbladder problems have happened in some people. Tell your doctor right away if you get symptoms. Taking Victoza with the sulfur, digestion, and constipation. Side effects can lead to dehydration, which may cause kidney problems.
Ask your doctor about Victoza.
Don't get in my way.
People come here to change the story of their lives. I imagined a story where I didn't have to be the damsel.
When you have a cold, stuff happens. Shut down cold symptoms fast with maximum strength Alka-Seltzer Plus liquid gels.
Listen up, heart disease. You too, unnecessary ER visits. And hey, unmanaged depression. Don't get too comfortable. We're talking to you, cost inefficiencies and data without insights. And fragmented care. Stop getting in the way of patient recovery. And pay attention. Every single one of you is on our list. At Optum, we're partnering across the health system to tackle its biggest challenges. Optum, how well gets done.
You ever call your broker for help?
When volatility spiked.
And?
By the time they got me an answer, it was too late.
TD Ameritrade's elite service team can handle your toughest questions right away.
Good to know.
We got your back, Kate.
Help from real traders, only with TD Ameritrade.
Tonight, believe it or not, Election Day is just days away. Yep, don't freak out. One of the biggest prizes, the governor's mansion in Virginia. The Democratic Lieutenant Governor, Ralph Northam, up against Trump-backed Republican Ed Gillespie. But also on the ballot in Virginia, a woman who says her inspiration to run was Donald Trump. And she's not alone. Kyung La is out front.
Not one, but countless introductions.
My name is Kimberly Tucker.
For this Democratic hopeful's campaign for Virginia's 81st House seat.
I know Donald Trump isn't central to your campaign at all, but he was part of the...
He inspired me.
He inspired you.
Absolutely. I think he inspired women to say, I'm not going to stand by and watch this.
Not my president!
We marched. We said no, but that's not enough.
It's no longer just march and talk. The female aftershock to Trump's 2016 political earthquake is on the ballot. In Tucker's home state of Virginia, November 7th, we'll see 51 women from major parties on the state ballot, a 60% increase compared to the last two comparable state election cycles. 26 of the 43 Democratic female candidates have never run for office before, an unprecedented number.
There's a lot of data you can look at.
Across the country, organizations training women to run for office report exponential growth in women signing up since November 2016. The nonpartisan group She Should Run says it went from 1,800 women to now 15,000 female trainees.
Election Day came and went, and the floodgates opened.
What do you think of the current gender makeup of the U.S. Capitol?
Well, it's disgraceful.
The women candidate in Virginia are a marker, a sign of what's in their training pipeline, pledge advocates.
While these women may be an exception, and that's an exceptional number for a state like Virginia, they will provide the inspiration that's needed for the I think, even bigger bump that we're going to see in future election cycles.
Thank you so much for coming out tonight.
Kimberly Ann Tucker's path here began months ago. Met the former public school teacher in February, protesting at a town hall, a member of grassroots group Indivisible, formed to fight the Trump agenda. A grandmother driven to protest for the first time in her life.
And now you are?
I'm a candidate for the House of Delegates.
You're on the ballot.
I'm on the ballot, yes.
That's quite a metamorphosis.
It is. I think I'm more surprised than anyone else that I know. I'm just knocking on doors to make sure that I talk to people.
Tucker is the assumed underdog in this predominantly Republican district.
I hope I can rely on you to vote for me. Thank you.
What did she say?
She said, I asked her if I could count on her vote, and she said absolutely.
One step forward on the long path.
Out front next, Tina Frost was shot in the Las Vegas massacre over a month ago. Doctors feared she might not survive, but Tina is now beating the odds. We have an update.
You supported him through 4 years of undergrad and medical school. It's no wonder he said, "You don't have to pick me up." At Lincoln Financial, we get there are some responsibilities of love you got to do on your own, and some you shouldn't have to shoulder alone, like being able to retire more confidently no matter what comes your way. Lincoln can help with income that lasts every year of your retirement, guaranteed. See how at lincolnfinancial.com.
Hey, I've got the trend analysis.
Hey.
Hi.
Hi.
You guys going to the company picnic this weekend?
Picnics are delightful.
Ugh, wish we could, but we're stuck here catching up on claims.
But we just compared historical claims to coverages.
Well, we have those new audits.
My natural language API can help us score those by noon.
Great. See you guys there.
We would not miss it.
Watson, you gotta learn how to take a hint.
I love to learn.
Attention Medicare beneficiaries. Many people with Medicare may be able to get extra benefits and don't even know they're available. You may be able to get dental, vision, hearing, and prescription drug coverage included in your plan. The Medicare Coverage Helpline is accepting calls.
Hi, I'm Dr. Jason Buchwald. Making sure you go to the doctor and taking all your medications as prescribed can help protect your health. To make it easier, you may now be able to enroll in a Medicare Advantage plan that includes coverage for dental, vision, and prescription drugs. Help protect your health by choosing the right plan for you and get all the benefits you deserve.
Call to see if you may be able to get extra benefits, including dental, vision, and prescription coverage. Don't delay. Call to see if you're eligible to enroll and may be able to get extra benefits now. Call 800-779-8200. That's 800-779-8200.
On the next Parts Unknown, The Calm Before the Storm. Anthony Bourdain in Puerto Rico, right before Hurricane Maria.
People think that Puerto Rico takes advantage of the states, but it's a two-way street.
The struggle.
I worry about my future.
And the strength.
I still want to live here. I still want to have that view.
Of Puerto Rico.
What will happen to this beautiful place?
All new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico. Sunday at 9 on CNN.
What's Truvia? It's a calorie-free sweetener, and its sweetness comes from nature, like this plant. Nature created this, and this, and this, and this. Wait, that's not nature. This is nature, and this nature specifically is what makes this sweet. So nature's zero-calorie sweetness is in this coffee, and in these drinks. Pick nature's calorie-free sweetness. Pick Truvia.
Who knew that phones would start doing everything? Entertaining us, getting us back on track, and finding us dates. Phones really have changed, so why hasn't the way we pay for them? Introducing Xfinity Mobile. You only pay for data and can easily switch between pay per gig and unlimited. No one else lets you do that. See how much you can save. Choose by the gig or unlimited. Xfinity Mobile, a new kind of network designed to save you money. Call, visit, or go to xfinitymobile.com. Save.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Tonight, a medical miracle. Out Front first brought you the story of Tina Frost, a young woman shot in the head during the Las Vegas massacre. For weeks, she had been in a coma, unable to breathe on her own. Doctors were unsure she would survive. But her mother telling Out Front, Tina is a fighter, and fighting she is. Now, just 1 month later, Tina is awake and walking, if you can believe it. Aaron spoke just yesterday with Amy Klinger, a close family friend. Here's part of their conversation.
Amy, you know, when we first heard this story, it brought us and so many others to tears. But wow, she is incredible. I mean, you just saw her. How is she?
She's amazing. It really is, like you said, totally unbelievable that it's only been a month and she's made such unbelievable progress. She is totally aware of her surroundings, and I feel really lucky to have been one of the first people to hear her speak after she just started speaking again on Tuesday night.
She, of course, was struck by a bullet and she lost her right eye. And now, you know, it's not just the walking and the talking. She's looking at People magazine in this picture in her hospital room. She's been using an iPad. You filmed this video of her walking. It's almost like she's doing sort of a squats, and she is so assured. I mean, how amazed is her family, are you, by this miracle?
It's exactly what you said. It's amazing to see her do it. I mean, to hear from other people who have visited, but to see it myself. And, you know, when you hear it, you're like, oh, okay, maybe a few steps, but she walked all the way around the entire, you know, unit that she is in. She did these squat walks, she did lunge walks, She did a grapevine kind of movement, all with the doctors just telling her, or the physical therapist telling her what to do, not even needing to kind of model the movement. They just told her what the next activity was going to be, and she comfortably did it.
What are doctors saying now, Amy, about her recovery? What happens next?
She'll continue to build up her strength. She's started to eat some solid foods. She's working on her speech. So all of these things are really amazing. She'll continue to do these for the next 2 weeks. And then at that time, she will have another surgery where they will begin like the facial reconstruction part of it.
And that obviously is I know, going to be so important. She comes into that with all of the strength that she has. I mean, she was at the festival with her boyfriend, Austin, and I know that he has been by her side. Since then, her family saying she just lights up when she sees him, which, look, it's just a beautiful thing to imagine. I mean, how is he coping?
Yes. He's from, I actually didn't have the opportunity to see him on Wednesday, but I did see, I kind of teased. I was like, I'm so sad I didn't get to see Austin. I hear she said he's such a cutie. And she giggled at me, and she really finds enormous support from him being there. She likes to hold his hand when she's there with him, and she really, really feels comfort having him by her side.
Now, when we last spoke to Tina's mom, she talked about the man who saved her daughter's life, and she only knew his name is Shane. That's all they knew. He had helped, of course, carry Tina into the back of the pickup truck and save her life. And I just wanted to play again what her mom said.
What do you want to say to him?
Thank you for saving my daughter's life.
Has the family had any luck in locating Shane?
So, yes, they have been able to locate him. After that story played through Tina's GoFundMe page, a colleague of Shane's who was also at the festival that weekend wrote a message to the GoFundMe page letting us know that Shane is a firefighter, a first responder from California who just happened to also be a festival goer, and he helped many people, and she was able to put Austin and Shane in touch with one another, and they, I'm not sure how frequently they're communicating now, but they did share some text messages earlier, you know, a couple weeks ago, and just showing such appreciation for Shane and all he did to help, you know, save Tina.
It's just wonderful that Austin can do that, and that they found Shane, and I know that's going to be a link that's going to be so important for Tina. Thank you so much as we root for her and those next big steps that she has coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
One remarkable story of so many coming from that horrific night. You yourself can help Tina. You can make a donation to her GoFundMe page. It's right there on your screen. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. AC360 starts right now.
Good evening. It's been a highly consequential week in the Rush investigation. We're now one guilty plea and two indictments into the probe, and it neither looks like the end or even the beginning of the end. And where things go from here is anybody's guess. What does seem clear tonight is that as the amount of testimony and documentary evidence grows, it'll get harder and harder for anyone involved to tell flat-out falsehoods or claim amnesia when the accumulated evidence might say otherwise, which hasn't stopped President Trump from trying. Here's the president back in February.
Can you say whether you are aware that anyone who advised your campaign had contacts with Russia during the course of the election?
Well, I told you General Flynn obviously was dealing, so that's one person, but he was dealing as he should have been.
During the election?
No, nobody that I know of.
Well, since then, we've learned that Jeff Sessions had on several occasions, Jared Kushner had in Trump Tower, Paul Manafort had with Jared Kushner at that same Trump Tower meeting, also George Papadopoulos. That's at least of all those we know about so far. He's the member of Papadopoulos is the member of then candidate Trump's foreign policy advisory panel who pleaded guilty to lying to the FBI, of course. Here he is in March of last year meeting with Mr. Trump. We now know, according to another participant in that meeting, that Papadopoulos pitched the idea of setting up a meeting with candidate Trump and Vladimir Putin. And Mr. Trump, quote, heard him out. Today, though, before leaving on his Asia trip, the president said he didn't remember.
I don't remember much about that meeting. It was a very unimportant meeting, took place a long time. Don't remember much about it.
President's memory fails him there. This is the president who just recently said his memory could never fail him. That's how good it is.
I think there's no hesitation. One of the great memories of all time.
One of the great memories of all time. As we said, though, it is not just the president's statements that are coming into question. It's those of his attorney general and others. CNN Chief National Security Correspondent Jim Sciutto joins us now with the latest on all that. Jim.
Anderson, the president's just arrived in Hawaii, embarking on arguably the most important overseas trip of his presidency, but with these questions still swirling, changing stories. First, he and his associates saying no meetings with Russians, as you noted. That turned out to be false. Then they said there was no discussion of anything untoward. That we now know is false because at least some of his advisors have discussed the question of dirt on Hillary Clinton to be supplied by the Russians. And we now know that this is very much of interest to the special counsel.
Tonight, new revelations darken the cloud of the Russia investigation hanging over the Trump administration. The first contradicting Attorney General Jeff Sessions' claims in testimony just last month.
You don't believe that surrogates from the Trump campaign had communications with the Russians. Is that what you're saying?
I did not, and I'm not aware of anyone else that did. And I don't believe it happened.
In fact, court filings unsealed this week show that former Trump campaign foreign policy advisor George Papadopoulos, who pleaded guilty to making false statements to federal investigators, suggested at a March 2016 meeting that Trump meet Russian President Vladimir Putin. A source adds that Sessions, then a top campaign national security advisor and surrogate, rejected the idea. Another former campaign foreign policy advisor, Carter Page, tells CNN that he testified before the House Intelligence Committee behind closed doors Thursday that he informed Sessions he was traveling to Russia during the 2016 presidential campaign, though he said that the trip was not tied to his role with the campaign. Papadopoulos' account is placing another Trump advisor under scrutiny, Sam Clovis, who served as deputy campaign chairman. Court documents show that Papadopoulos contacted a campaign supervisor, who the Washington Post has identified as Clovis, about a potential trip to Russia to meet Russian officials. The supervisor responded, encouraging Papadopoulos to make the trip. Papadopoulos' account was unsealed the same day as indictments of former campaign chairman Paul Manafort and his deputy Rick Gates in relation to their lobbying work for the Ukraine government. In the indictments, the government alleges that they received tens of millions of dollars for their work, and to hide that income, laundered the money through, quote, scores of United States and foreign corporations, partnerships, and bank accounts. Manafort and Gates have pleaded not guilty to charges, which cover activities prior to Trump's presidential campaign.
And Jim, I understand you're learning more about Paul Manafort and Rick Gates and when a trial might be.
That's right. There's now a proposed date for May 7th, this, of course, of 2018. That could move a little bit. The estimate is it'll take at least 3 weeks for the trial. And keep in mind, that's going to take it into the summer of 2018, which is, of course, before the very important midterm elections. We know the president has wanted this investigation to end, this cloud hanging over him to disappear. But we know at a minimum, with Manafort and Gates, it's going to continue well into next year.
Jim, thanks very much. Perspective now from X-Files host and former senior Obama advisor, David Axelrod. I mean, it's hard to believe, David, it's almost, you know, it was just 4 days ago that Manafort and Gates turned themselves in. We found out about Papadopoulos.
Yes, well, I think the Papadopoulos element was one that really jarred everyone around the president because whereas they were expecting the Manafort indictment and perhaps Gates, they were comfortable that that was about other matters. At least on the surface, it was about something that had nothing to do with the campaign. And then Papadopoulos came along and, as part of his proffer in his plea, mentioned others in the campaign who he talked to or at least referred to other campaign officials. And that promises trouble down the line. This is how prosecutions work. You start at the corners of this and you work toward the center of the puzzle. And I'm sure that that is one of the reasons why the president has been so outspoken this week about other matters and pointing in other directions. There is a great deal of anxiety around that White House right now.
Well, you also get the sense that we really have only seen a tiny portion of what a special counsel Mueller already has. I mean, the proverbial tip of the iceberg.
Yeah, this is the way these things work. They take time. Everyone is impatient to know how the story ends. But if you look at all of these major investigations, they tend not to unfold that way. And oftentimes, one thing leads to another. And as you work your way up. Now, we don't know where it will lead. But clearly, it's not going to stop with George Papadopoulos or with Manafort or Gates. There's going to be more. I think there seems to be broad agreement on that.
And the president has certainly turned up the volume this week on his calls for Secretary Clinton and the Democrats to be investigated. Would you imagine that these calls from the president are only going to increase?
Oh, absolutely. Look, one of the habits of Donald Trump is when there's an inconvenient blaze over here, he starts one over here. And all week long, he's been hammering on the justice system itself relative to the events in New York and the terrorist attack. They're calling our justice system a laughingstock. And then starting last night and into this morning, basically demanding, even as he said it wasn't his place to do so, demanding that the Justice Department open up investigations on Hillary Clinton and others. And, you know, I think this is his reaction to the growing intensity of the Mueller investigation. But the thing, Anderson, that gets me is here's a president who so willfully and so enthusiastically exploits passions around the flag, passions around the national anthem. Doesn't apparently appreciate what those symbols stand for. One of the most important things that separates us from autocracies is the fact that presidents of the United States can't order the justice system to go after, he said they ought to go after Hillary Clinton, to go after his political opponents. There's been, for time immemorial, a separation between presidents and their justice departments and the FBI. When I was in the White House, I couldn't contact the Justice Department. I couldn't contact the FBI, nor did I try. But if I had an issue, it was plain. You go to the White House counsel, he would be the repository of your requests. He would follow up on things. The president was very cautious when I was in the White House about commenting on matters that were under investigation. So this is a complete departure from a tradition, and it's a dangerous one. And as this thing intensifies, God knows where it's going to lead.
Yeah, David Axelrod, appreciate it. Thanks tonight. Next, Hillary Clinton's campaign manager speaking out for the first time about the former Democratic Party chair's claim that the primary, was rigged. And later, explosive allegations about the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. kept secret for nearly half a century in the JFK assassination files. We'll talk about the facts, if any, behind them, why they were kept secret, why the FBI was collecting all this information, and why J. Edgar Hoover was so focused on Dr. King.
Friday nights on Anderson Cooper 360 are sponsored by Hainan Airlines. Fly your dreams.
Hainan Airlines is bringing the Chongqing Three Gorges and the incredibly adorable Chengdu pandas closer to the Big Apple. With twice weekly non-stop flights from New York to Chongqing and New York to Chengdu, travelers can expect faster, direct access between North America and Central China. Fly your dreams on the five-star premium Hainan Airlines.
Eras, they're defined by accomplishments, by victories, by those with the resourcefulness, the ingenuity, and the grit to help ensure the next energy to power our dreams will be American energy. This is our era. This is America's energy era. Next Era Energy.
He's brought us to the brink of nuclear war. Accused of obstructing justice at the FBI and of violating the Constitution by taking money from foreign governments and threatening to shut down news organizations that report the truth. If that isn't a case for impeaching and removing a dangerous president, then what has our government become? I'm Tom Steyer, and like you, I'm a citizen who knows it's up to us to do something. It's why I'm funding this effort to raise our voices together and demand that elected officials take a stand on impeachment. A Republican Congress once impeached a president for far less. Yet today, people in Congress and his own administration know that this president is a clear and present danger, who's mentally unstable and armed with nuclear weapons. And they do nothing. Join us and tell your member of Congress that they have a moral responsibility to stop doing what's political and start doing what's right. Our country depends on it.
If you need anything from a simple home repair to a major remodel, you need to know about Home Advisor. It's a totally free service that matches you with background check pros for any home project. You can compare prices, read verified reviews from local homeowners, and book an appointment all online. Start your next home repair or improvement project at homeadvisor.com or download the free app. Home Advisor.
Look at this, a Silicon Valley server farm. The vault to man's greatest wonders. Selfies, cat videos, and winking emojis. Speaking of tech wonders, with the Geico app, you can get roadside assistance, digital ID cards, or even file a claim.
Do that. Yeah, that should work.
It's not happening.
Just try again.
I think I found your problem.
Thanks.
The award-winning Geico app. Download it today.
Controversy and accusations have swirled over the last day and a half since the former DNC chair publicly claimed that the Democratic primary was rigged in Hillary Clinton's favor. Not only top Democrats, but also the president himself weighed in. Here's his comments from today.
You ought to look at Hillary Clinton and you ought to look at the new book that was just put out by Donna Brazile, where she basically bought the DNC and she stole the election from Bernie. So that's what you ought to take a look at.
Well, now for the first time, Clinton's former campaign manager, Robbie Mook, speaks out. He'll join me in just a moment. But first, breaking news, a new document comes out that sheds light on the story, seen as Breonna Keeler joins me now. So what exactly is Donna Brazile claiming that prompted this reaction from President Trump?
Well, so in excerpts of her new book, Anderson, Donna Brazile alleges that an agreement that Hillary Clinton's primary campaign signed with the DNC gave the Clinton campaign control over who the party hired, how they spent money, even before winning the nomination. But we have read the documents. This is the key one here. And what she's talking about isn't backed up really by what we read in these documents. What we do know is that the DNC was broke following the Obama years. The Clinton campaign wanted the DNC in good shape for the general election, presuming that Hillary Clinton would be the nominee. So they were, as is allowed, joint fundraising with the party. They eventually raised almost $50 million for it. And they did have this agreement that they would get, for instance, input on a communications director hire during the primary. In the end, the DNC didn't even stick to that. But this idea that there would be input on how much money would be raised, how that would be spent for general election expenses, that actually didn't happen. And this document further emphasizes the committee's neutrality when it came to making decisions related to primary debates.
So, Breonna, I mean, the Democratic Party was pro Hillary Clinton, right? I mean, even if that wasn't why they made this formal agreement.
Absolutely. The Democratic Party apparatus was pro-Hillary. All of the big Democratic money and staff talent mobilized behind her. They really shut out all of the other potential establishment Democratic candidates from putting together viable campaigns by doing that. And that's why there was an opening only for a candidate like Bernie Sanders, who was not an establishment Democratic candidate. But the document is not how it's not the key here. It's not the key to how the field was cleared for Hillary Clinton. The key was actually, and ironically, people like Donna Brazile and other people. That is the ridiculously ironic part about this. Remember, Donna Brazile resigned from CNN because she was caught in the WikiLeaks emails funneling a town hall question to the Clinton campaign, trying to help Clinton out. And now she is promoting her book, which certainly exploits party divisions that she helped create. And the bottom line is this is really the side of politics that just grosses everyone out, Anderson.
Right. Breonna Keeler, appreciate it. Thanks. Joining me now is Robbie Mook, the former Clinton campaign chairman. Robbie, thanks for joining us. So you heard Breonna's report. The memo says your campaign got to weigh in on who the communications director was before the general election. Was that fair?
Well, first of all, Anderson, I just want to underscore some things Breonna said. First of all, when the DNC approached both campaigns about a joint fundraising agreement, they were broke. They weren't going to make payroll. They were not going to be able to transfer down money to the state parties to keep them operational. They were in a really bad place. Both the Sanders campaign and the Clinton campaign signed joint fundraising agreements. So we both thought it was a good thing to sign up for. The only difference was Sanders didn't raise any money in, and we did. The DNC appealed to us.
Sanders was raising money in a, I mean, you guys had big big money donors, Sanders was getting more donations from you know, individuals and smaller donations, no?
Well, and that would have been great. It would have been great for the DNC to raise jointly with him. Hillary turned over her email list to the DNC after the election was over. So it's really important for those low dollar donors to be part of the DNC process. But the DNC came to our campaign and said, we need help. We're not prepared for the general election. We created the memo of understanding that was there. It wasn't about the primary election. And as Brianna said, we were very frustrated with the DNC many times. The idea that we had any control over there is pretty laughable.
Right,
but we simply put guardrails in about how the money that we raised needed to be focused on the general election activities that were really going to matter.
Right, but my understanding is that communications position actually had to be filled even before the primary races.
Well, that's correct. I mean, this is a perfect
example. So that wasn't just about the general election, right?
Well, no, but it absolutely is. The purpose of the DNC while a primary is going on is to hold Republican candidates accountable. And there was nobody filling that post. It was a big problem. It was something that any Democrat should have been worried about. That's why if you look in that memo, we explicitly set a date whereby they have to hire someone because we were distressed that there was no lead voice out there speaking out against Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and everybody else.
But was the Sanders campaign also offered the chance to enter into an agreement where they too could have a say in who the DNC was hiring?
They were. And if you look at the memo that came out this evening, it explicitly says in that memo that we as the Clinton campaign acknowledged that other campaigns were welcome to enter into agreement with the DNC of their own. In fact, honestly, Anderson, we would have beyond welcomed that. More resources coming into the DNC. We would have loved to have partnered with the Sanders campaign, talking about all the issues of how to organize and prepare for the general election. We had a very good working relationship with the Sanders campaign, particularly as the primary came to a close. I worked very closely with Jeff Weaver. We got a lot done. We got the Unity Commission that's there set up.
But clearly,
so we
Jeff
would have
Weaver,
welcomed that.
Right, but clearly Jeff Weaver and the Sanders campaign believes that things were rigged against them.
Well, here's what I'll say about this. You know, politics is politics. People have to go there, go out there and say what they need to say. I think it's dangerous to say that this contest was rigged for the following reason.
Because Elizabeth Warren, by the way, is also saying that now.
Well, and Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders are important members of our party. They're an important part of our politics. We can't make the case to working people in this country that we're going to stand up for them and we're going to fight for them if we're fighting each other. We can't do that. Hillary Clinton won this primary with almost 4 million votes. That's a bigger lead than Barack Obama had over her when she lost and conceded in 2008. The idea that the DNC could rig a contest, frankly, is laughable. And here's the last thing I'll say. You know, the caucus contests within the larger primary are the contests that are run by the party. You know, the primary elections are run by secretaries of state. Those contests, the caucuses that were run by the party, Bernie Sanders won overwhelmingly. So if we look at what the party actually managed in this process, Bernie Sanders won those contests. I think we only won 3 of them, and we barely won Iowa. So there's just no evidence to back this up. I understand how it's convenient. Some people like, you know, they want to be angry at what's going on. But we've got to focus our anger on Donald Trump and this outrageous tax plan that the Republicans are proposing.
So is this just about Donna Brazile trying to peddle a book? I mean, because as Brianna mentioned, you know, through somebody who didn't work at CNN, she gained access to one town hall question, and she gave that, or at least attempted to, or in an email, gave it to somebody in the Clinton campaign, which is completely unethical. She lost her job. I frankly view it as a huge betrayal of everybody who worked at CNN, the fact that she did that. I don't see her attempting to give information to the Sanders campaign. It seemed like she was more than happy to cozy up to the Clinton campaign, and now she has a book to sell. She's now spinning this yarn.
You know, I feel like all this is water under the bridge. And Donna Brazile has served our party for 30 years. She's been a champion for Democrats. It was my honor and my privilege to work with her as chair of our party. I look forward to working with Donna in the future.
Do you think it was appropriate for her to do that about a town hall question?
I don't honestly know the specifics of it. It sounds like CNN looked into it and took action as they saw fit. But again, Anderson, I'm just not interested in these things in the past. This is why we've got to move beyond 2016. We have a governor's election less than a week away in Virginia. We've got critical midterm elections. And I can't say it enough. This tax plan the Republicans are proposing is okay. Outrageous. So that's the fight. That's where we need to be as Democrats.
I do also want to ask you about the dossier, obviously, because we haven't had you on the record on that. Were you aware that the Clinton campaign was at least in part funding it along with the DNC? But I'll only ask you about the Clinton campaign because the campaign chair, John Podesta, says he had no idea. I talked to Brian Fallon. He said he had no idea. I mean, it seems like nobody in the Clinton campaign has stood up and said, oh, yeah, I knew this. And I was the one who helped sign off on it.
Well, look, I didn't know that we were paying the contractor that created that document. I didn't. I'll tell you, you know, what I did know. And that is that when we started to look into Donald Trump's business dealings, it was this massive tree of LLCs and shell companies. We were overwhelmed. We were out of our league on it, frankly. And so I asked our lawyer and I gave him a budget allocation to investigate this, particularly the international aspect. My understanding is that dossier is the product of not just research that was funded by our campaign, but also by Republican donors, and that they put that all together and gave that to the press.
Right, right. Jonathan Steele was hired, I guess, after the Republican people started it, dropped out, and once you guys were paying for it. But I mean, I know the dossier was something that was compiled later. Were you or other people in the campaign or who in the campaign was seeing the memos that Jonathan Steele was putting out? I mean, you guys are paying for opposition research. You must have been seeing the fruits of that throughout the campaign, no?
Well, we were getting briefings that were put together by the law firm with information. I don't know where it came from, though.
We've hired this guy, Jonathan Steele, and he's got sources in Russia, and this is information in drips and drabs?
What I know is that...
Yeah,
well, what I've known is what I've read in the press, that I think it was $1.2 million that was spent on this overall project, and that I think it was like $120,000, some fraction of that went to this Steele company. So I don't know who else, you know, contributed to these reports.
But were you seeing
it was packaged for us?
You must have been seeing. I mean, you're saying get briefings from the lawyer. You must have been seeing. What was it in memo form? Memos of okay. Now there's this interview, and this person is saying this about the president's business dealings in Russia or this activity.
Well, when you're on a campaign, you have a strategic team. And you come together and go over all this information. So our internal team was presenting information, our lawyer was presenting information, you know, and we sort of learn things in pieces. I just can't attribute to you what piece of information, you know, came to us at what time or where it came from, frankly. You know, as campaign manager, there's a lot going on. And so I just wanted to know what was important to find out.
Okay, just finally, is there somebody at the DNC, I mean, you were the campaign manager, is there somebody at the DNC, maybe at a slightly lower level, who knew about Christopher Steele, who didn't just know, okay, yeah, we're paying this lawyer, and all of a sudden, magically, this information is coming back to us, who actually knew the nuts and bolts of who was gathering the information, how it was being gathered?
I don't know the answer to that. It's possible some at the DNC knew about this. We had dozens of researchers on the campaign. In fact, one of the reasons we were trying to get resources into the DNC was to make sure that they had a lot of opposition researchers working on all these Republicans. So I unfortunately don't know the answer.
And to those who say, you know, that this could have been some sort of collusion, if Christopher Steele is being fed disinformation from people who had connections to the Russian government, that essentially your campaign was helping pay for some of that disinformation.
Well, look, they chose what to put in that dossier. And so I can't speak to that. I'm proud that we were able to assemble some of the research that has brought this to light. Because, I mean, Anderson, you have to remember, I went on television the first day of the convention. My colleagues were on television saying something's wrong with Russia. Russia hacked the DNC. Russia, when John Podesta was hacked, Russia hacked John Podesta. And what Fusion was doing. But I'm just glad that we're paying attention to this now. And frankly, I wish we'd paid more attention to it on the campaign.
All right, Robbie Mook, appreciate your time, Robbie.
Thanks
very much. Up next, breaking news from the JFK assassination files. This is pretty explosive stuff. Explosive FBI dossier, not about JFK, but on the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We'll explain what's just been released.
Endless Shrimp is here with incredible flavors like new Nashville Hot Shrimp. Crispy, spicy, and drizzled with sweet amber honey. Plus the delicious classics you love like garlic shrimp scampi. Try all the shrimp you want, however you want them. But hurry, it ends soon.
If you move your old 401k to a Fidelity IRA, we make sure you're in the loop at every step, from the moment you decide to move your money to the instant your new retirement account is funded. Because when you know where you stand, things are just clearer.
Hey, I'm thinking about switching my car insurance. Who do you have? I really have to call Amica. If you ask around, pretty soon you'll learn there are auto insurance customers and then there are Amica customers. Do some research and you'll be impressed.
This is it. I'm calling Amica for a quote.
Good rate?
Good everything.
We make it easy to save money, too, with our long list of auto insurance discounts. Get your free quote now.
Welcome to Amica. This is helpfulness. Insured.
You don't have an issue sharing your husband?
People can have more than one soulmate.
I'll say it's crazy. Loving another man who's married.
Monogamy doesn't work for a lot of people.
This is Life with Lisa Lang, Sunday night at 10 on CNN.
Wednesday.
Why are you interested in working at our company?
Real people.
First impression is everything.
Push, pull.
Real jobs.
What do you think makes you a good fit?
Real interviews.
You did a great job.
Televised.
Fantastic.
Somebody.
I really want this job.
About to get.
I'm always the person that strategizes.
Hired.
I think it's going to be a tough decision.
The Job Interview, Wednesday at 10, CNBC. Get yours.
Honey, this gig speed internet is ridiculously fast.
I know, right? We are seriously keeping up with the Joneses.
I know, right? We are seriously keeping up with the Andersons.
We are finally keeping up with the Fords.
Keeping up with the Garcias.
Keeping up with the Harveys.
Keeping up with the
Romeros.
Carters.
Patels.
The Allens.
Willans.
Right. Them.
No one's gonna have internet like this.
No one's gonna have internet like this.
Gig speed internet from Xfinity. Over here. It's not just for the Joneses.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
There's breaking news tonight coming from the National Archives and another batch of JFK assassination files. They include, though, an explosive FBI dossier, not on JFK, but on Dr. Martin Luther King, the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. It reflects then-Director J. Edgar Hoover's deep suspicion and obsession with Dr. King, which was certainly no secret at the time. And it speaks to just how far he and the FBI went to try and discredit Dr. King. The dossier released today contains items that are both, and I say explosive, but they are unsubstantiated. CNN's Gary Tuchman joins us now with more. So what are you learning? What's in this stuff?
Well, Anderson, among the more than 600 documents released late today by the National Archives is this one, a never-before-seen file titled Martin Luther King Jr., A Current Analysis. It's dated March 12, 1968, and includes a number of explosive allegations about the civil rights leader who was assassinated 23 days after this report was first compiled. Among the claims detailed, Martin Luther King Jr. was involved in extramarital affairs and other sexual activities that, if true and revealed publicly, would have been devastating to Dr. King and his movement. In addition, there are pages and pages detailing Martin Luther King and his organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, with alleged ties to known communists, and finally details about supposed financial improprieties by Dr. King and the SCLC. Now, I want to stress that the FBI, under Director J. Edgar Hoover at the time, had been investigating Martin Luther King Jr. for years at this point in the hopes of finding damaging information, and that we have no way of corroborating these allegations.
So what does this have to do with the investigation of the assassin of JFK? Because I don't quite get why this document would have been in there with that.
Exactly. That's one of the many questions we have tonight, Anderson. Considering the document has no mention of John F. Kennedy or his assassination, the only clue we have in this file marked secret is it's also stamped, reviewed by the FBI JFK Task Force and dated May 8th, 1994, meaning it was reviewed by the Archives JFK Task Force 23 years ago, but kept secret until today.
There are still thousands of JFK assassination documents that have not been released, right?
Right. And that's also still unclear what's going on with that. We do know that last week President Trump sent out this tweet that read in part, after strict consultation with General Kelly, the CIA, and other agencies, I will be releasing all JFK files other than the names and addresses of any person who is still living. And they are being released on a rolling basis by the National Archives. There are still thousands of pages yet to be released.
So much more to come, Anderson.
All right. Thanks very much. Appreciate it, Gary. There's a lot more ahead to cover throughout this hour and the next 2 hours in front. I want to bring in Doug Brinkley and also Claiborne Carson. Doug Brinkley, obviously, is a presidential historian. Claiborne Carson is the founding director of Stanford University's Martin Luther King Jr. Research and Education Institute. Dr. Carson, what do you make of you know, this being released, the information in it, and is any of it new to you? Because I feel like a lot of it has been sort of out there before.
I think the allegation that King had affairs during his lifetime have certainly been out there. J. Edgar Hoover conducted a vendetta against King. And it started with the allegation that he had ties to communists. That really didn't lead anywhere. There were people who were associated with Martin Luther King who had, in the past, had ties to the Communist Party. But that investigation did not produce anything of great note. King fired the one person he felt was still involved with the organization. He continued to have a contact with Stanley Levison, who had once been a member of the Communist Party. But the result of that was that Hoover then got authorization from Robert Kennedy to tap the phones and bug the rooms of Martin Luther King. And that led to information about King's sexual activity, which Hoover tried to peddle to news media. He was pretty much unsuccessful during his lifetime. And I think what's striking about this is that this was a file that could have been released in 1968. Mm. And in that climate, it probably, you can hardly guess how people would have responded to it, because it's simply an allegation,
right,
by an unnamed person, an informant. And it's striking that I've gone through some of the JFK documents that were released. The FBI and other federal agencies go to great lengths to keep out the names of informants and their own activities. Hmm. But in this case, it seems like what they're really doing is invading the privacy of a person. Assuming that this is true, they're definitely invading the privacy of the offspring,
yeah,
of this relationship.
The
relationship itself, it's not the person that we should be asking is the informant.
Yeah.
Doug, whoever gave this information.
Doug Brinkley, one of the things that's so interesting about this is that how sort of the public understanding of Dr. King has changed over the course of time. But you look back at, you think back to this time and what a revolutionary figure he was. We think of him through a particular lens, but he was also focusing on the Vietnam War, on poverty in America, in addition to the quest for social justice and civil rights. But you really get a sense of the fear, the concern the FBI had about him because he was such a transformational figure.
Absolutely, and I agree with everything Dr. Carson just said, but let me add, what makes this a bombshell document is the date, March 12, 1968. You know, only weeks later, Martin Luther King Jr. will be dead. And the FBI, people are wondering, what did the FBI hound King to his fate? This is not a good document for the FBI. It shows them deeply paranoid about what they call the Washington Spring Project, the March on Washington of 68, the Poor People's March. But the lead of the document is the fear the FBI has that Stokely Carmichael and black nationalists have teamed up with Dr. King and the first wave civil rights Christian group and are now going to have a violent America in the spring. They quote Dr. King saying, apparently in this FBI document, King once said jail's going to be the only safe place to be this spring because there's going to be so much violence in America. So the fact that the FBI ginned this out, I mean, a couple weeks later, Lyndon Johnson doesn't run for re-election at the end of March of 68. And there's this fear that this summer may be a very, very violent one. And they're following King around in this document right up till March. I mean, there's stories about sex parties in Miami in 1968. Some of this is almost X-rated stuff in these 23 pages of smearing, really, of Dr. King.
Well, Dr. Carson, that's the thing about this. I mean, when I first heard about this, you know, there's obviously the concern that something like this could harm Dr. King's legacy. But when you actually start to look at it, it really just seems to reflect terribly on J. Edgar Hoover and the FBI at the time.
Well, I think, again, if this had been released in 1968, the first thing anyone would have done would have been to question the source. These are anonymous informants who are spreading dirt about Martin Luther King. Obviously, some of them are black informants who probably disagreed with King's position on the war and other things at that time. So the motives of these people need to be questioned, as well as what they're alleging about Martin Luther King. Mm. And I think that when we look closely at this, what we see is that there is a person who is trying his best to damage Martin Luther King's reputation. And, you know, I wish in some ways that, well, I wish obviously that person had been named,
yeah,
so that then we could go to that person and say, well, what was the basis of this?
Hmm. Claiborne Carson, I appreciate you being on. Doug Brinkley as well. Thank you. As we've seen in recent weeks and months over again, this White House is troubled with the facts at times, with the truth. Now you might say all White Houses lie, but New York Times columnist Frank Bruni says Press Secretary Sarah Sanders has taken it to a whole other level. Talk to him next.
Look forward to seeing you.
He's brought us to the brink of nuclear war, accused of obstructing justice at the FBI and of violating the Constitution by taking money from foreign governments and threatening to shut down news organizations that report the truth. If that isn't a case for impeaching and removing a dangerous president, then what has our government become? I'm Tom Steyer, and like you, I'm a citizen who knows it's up to us to do something. It's why I'm funding this effort to raise our voices together and demand Congress and his own administration know that this president is a clear and present danger, who's mentally unstable and armed with nuclear weapons, and they do nothing. Join us and tell your member of Congress that they have a moral responsibility to stop doing what's political and start doing what's right. Our country depends on it.
Vote now for the CNN Hero of the Year at CNNHeroes.com and Facebook Messenger.
Coffee?
Please.
How's Alex handling everything?
True to who you've been all season and do what got you there.
He's battled back and he has once again shown his dominance.
We've already shown that we can win.
Keselowski's going to win at Talladega.
I think this could be the year for us.
You don't get to be the best by being the nice guy.
I feel like I've already done the impossible.
Make room, Richard Petty and Dale Earnhardt. There's another seven-time champ.
The Wonder List with Bill Weir, tomorrow at 9 on CNN.
To see someone in government not tell the truth is certainly nothing new, and to hear White House press secretaries spin information certainly isn't new either. But have we now entered a new age of misinformation? Frank Bruni from the New York Times wrote a piece about that today, focusing on Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders. Her trouble with the truth goes back long before this week, though. Everything you're about to hear is in this soundbite is actually not true.
I don't think it's appropriate to lie from the podium or any other place. He said the process has people calling us a joke and calling us a laughing stock. This is what we're about.
Specifically said that he received the phone call from the president of Mexico.
They were actually direct. They were direct conversations, not actual phone calls.
So he lied. He didn't receive.
I wouldn't say it was a lie. It was. That's pretty bold accusation. It's the conversations took place. They just simply didn't take place over a phone call that he had them in person. And I have heard from a large number of individuals that work at the FBI that said that they're very happy with the president's decision.
The president keeps repeating this claim that we're the highest tax nation.
And that's what we are, the highest tax corporate nation.
That's not what he said. He said we're the highest tax nation in the world.
The highest tax corporate nation. It seems pretty consistent to me. Sorry, we're just going to have to agree to disagree.
Well, joining me is New York Times op-ed columnist Frank Bruni and Scott Jennings, former special assistant to President George W. Bush. Frank, you write that you watched Sarah Sanders' press briefings with what you described as sheer awe. I know you didn't mean it as a compliment. In fact, you say, quote, we've surrendered any expectation of honesty, and that you actually miss Sean Spicer. Can you just explain that?
When I watched Sean Spicer, he would get this panicked look. He would appear to me flustered, like he kind of knew he was a man swimming against the current and he was never going to keep his head above water. Sarah Huckabee Sanders seems utterly at peace with the fictions that she peddles. And I find that disturbing. I also find it disturbing. I don't see her attracting the censor or the ridicule that Sean Spicer did. And I think that's because 9 months into the Trump administration, we are all so accustomed to being lied to. We're so accustomed to seeing, villain portrayed as victim, bad portrayed as good. And that really worries me because I worry, bigger than her, I worry that the Trump administration is lowering our standards for government.
You think this has become normalized?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think it's not normal. Listen, every press secretary, I've been around for a while, as have you, every press secretary that we've watched over the decades has tried to make his or her boss look, as heroic as possible, portray them in the best light. And to that extent, some of what she's doing is just par for the course. But she goes the extra mile.
Scott, I'm wondering what you make of what Frank is saying and the job that Sarah Sanders is doing.
Well, two things. Number one, I think that if what you're wishing for is for a White House press secretary to walk out to the podium and trash their boss or correct their boss or sort of line up with where the press corps is on Donald Trump, that is not going to happen. It's not going to happen in this White House. It's not going to happen in any White House. And number two, I appreciate what Frank says about previous press secretaries, but I think that he's describing Sarah Sanders and Sean Spicer before her as though they have taken it to a level we've never seen. When I remember watching Josh Earnest at the podium lie about the nature of President Ronald Reagan's victories. I remember watching him lie about the $400 million in ransom we paid Iran. And I don't remember anybody showing outrage about the White House press secretary then. So I tend to think people are viewing these press secretaries through the lens of their own personal hatred for the president. And that is rubbing off on how they view the staff.
Frank?
Well, I respectfully disagree. I think if you watch, especially over the last week, and that's why I wrote the column at the end of this week, if you watch Sarah Huckabee Sanders' behavior at the lectern this week, there's a kind of contempt that she and so many other people in the Trump administration show for the media that I think is beyond what we've seen before.
Well, Frank, the moment we heard earlier when Sanders was pressed on the president's assertion that the U.S. is flat out the highest tax nation on earth, in fact, that's not accurate. And she weaved this response. I guess the president's allies would say, look, she's just helping him clarify his remarks.
Well, I mean, she is, but she's also pretending that that's exactly what he said. And there was a moment this week when Jim Acosta said, you know, the president said that our justice system is a joke and a laughingstock. And she got into it with him. She corrected him and she gave him a different version of it that, in fact, was farther from his verbatim words than what Jim Acosta had explained. There's this reflexive, you are all wrong and we are all right.
I think frequently Sarah is in the position of having to explain again and again and again what Donald Trump does so well. He absorbs people's emotions and then he reflects those emotions, particularly of his base, in a lot of his comments. And I think that is frequently mischaracterized as her lying or as her trying to clean things up. But she's explaining what Donald Trump is doing, and it continues to baffle the media that that's what he does very well. And so I think that press secretaries over the years have evolved from public information officers into essentially the chief White House pundit. They are the core reflection of how the occupant of the Oval Office sees the world. And we're holding Sarah and we held Sean to a standard that I'm not sure we held previous press secretaries to. Maybe we should have, and that's a debate we could have. But you use the word contempt. I mean, if she holds you all in contempt, I mean, I would respectfully say that the media, frankly, looks like they hold Donald Trump in contempt. And so the contempt is flowing both ways. I tend to agree ratcheting down the contempt would be better. But this is not a one-way street when it comes to contempt in this briefing room right now.
It's not a one-way street, but to pretend that we can evaluate Sean Spicer and Sarah Huckabee Sanders in the context of all previous press secretaries is to pretend something bigger, which is that Donald Trump is a truly normal president. And would you really say that, Scott?
No, I agree with you. This is not a normal presidency as compared to what we've seen. But I do think what is normal is the White House press secretary essentially being a reflection of how that particular president views the world. Now, how he views the world may be different and abnormal, as you put it, but that doesn't make the press secretary abnormal in what they're doing, which is reflecting how their boss sees things.
When she was asked about the president's ridiculous and, you know, incredibly inappropriate tweet about Mika Brzezinski, she kind of went on this reverie about what a heroic man he was and how he's so tough and strong and that's why Americans love him. It's always a little bit too much and too far. Now, if that's what the president demands, that's what the president demands, but she is under no obligation to continue serving him.
Well, not only is that what the president demands in this case, but what you just described to her is exactly what Donald Trump does. I mean, you would probably argue that he always goes too far, that he takes things too far.
That,
so
yes.
Again, I go back to this point. The White House press secretary has become a reflection of the thinking of their boss. It was true for Obama's press people, for Bush's, for Clinton's, you know, and it seems to get more pronounced as time goes on. But it is not unique to this White House. Even if this presidency is not normal, it's not unique to this White House.
Well, Frank Bruni, Scott Jennings, appreciate it. Thank you. Up next, what President Trump says about military judge's decision to not give Bo Bergdahl prison time for deserting his post in Afghanistan. We'll also talk with retired Navy SEAL Jimmy Hatch, who was badly wounded in the search for Bergdahl. His unit's canine was also killed. Hatch spoke in court, came face to face with the man he nearly died searching for. His take on Bergdahl's sentence in a moment.
Seamaster Aquaterra. Omega.
On the next Parts Unknown, The Calm Before the Storm. Anthony Bourdain in Puerto Rico, right before Hurricane Maria.
People think that Puerto Rico takes advantage of the states, but it's a two-way street.
The struggle.
I worry about my future.
And the strength.
I still want to live here. I still want to have that view
of Puerto Rico.
What will happen to this beautiful place?
All new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico. Sunday at 9 on CNN.
For Commonwealth Court, only one judge grew up in poverty. Ellen Seisler. Only one judge prosecuted violent criminals. Ellen Seisler. Endorsed by police, firefighters, and teachers. Ellen Seisler.
A bridge shut down over politics. Their biggest triumph was a traffic jam. Chris Christie and Kim Guadagno's failures shortchanged our future. After 8 years, incomes are down, costs are up, and our economy is crawling. We are better than this. I'm Phil Murphy.
Together, we'll build a stronger, fairer economy that works for every New Jersey family.
Christie and Guadagno left New Jersey stuck.
I'm serious about moving New Jersey forward.
For Commonwealth Court, only one judge grew up in poverty, Ellen Seisler. Only one judge prosecuted violent criminals, Ellen Seisler. Endorsed by police, firefighters, and teachers, Ellen Seisler.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Bo Bergdahl is a free man tonight, not heading to a prison cell for a lengthy incarceration. A military judge has sentenced Bergdahl to a dishonorable discharge from the Army and no prison time. The decision after Bergdahl pleaded guilty to desertion and misbehaving in front of the enemy. In 2009, as you may know, Bergdahl walked away from his base in Afghanistan. He was captured by the Taliban and held for almost 5 years. Bergdahl has said he spent most of that time living in a metal cage or chained to a bed, repeatedly beaten and tortured. Bergdahl was released in a controversial prisoner swap for five Guantanamo Bay detainees. Today on Twitter, the president slammed the judge's sentence, writing, "The decision on Sergeant Bergdahl is a complete and total disgrace to our country and to our military." Several service members were badly wounded looking for Bergdahl in Afghanistan. Their lives, their families' lives have been forever changed. Navy SEAL Jimmy Hatch was shot in the leg searching for Bergdahl. He's gone through 18 surgeries, had to retire from the military, and experienced a lot of difficult days wrestling with PTSD. Also, his unit's combat dog named Remco was killed in the search for Bergdahl. Jimmy Hatch now runs a nonprofit group called Spike's Canine Fund, which buys life-saving ballistic vests for military dogs and police dogs around the country. He testified during Bergdahl's sentencing, and it's an honor to talk to him tonight. Jimmy, first of all, what went through your mind when you heard what Bergdahl's sentence was, that he wouldn't serve any time in prison?
There's people right now in military brigs that are serving sentences and dishonorable discharges that did less than go AWOL and get a lot of Americans hurt and chanced a lot of Americans with getting killed.
For you, the most important thing, I understand, was that he be dishonorably discharged.
Yeah, it was. And so I guess I got my wish with regard to that.
Yeah, I mean, Bergdahl's defense cited, you know, his treatment in captivity as a reason for him to avoid prison time, saying essentially, you know, he's been through enough as a Taliban hostage. I've heard you say that you don't really think he gets the right to call himself a hostage.
Right. Well, essentially, he was a volunteer now, wasn't he? So I guess, you
By
know,
by walking
if you
off, you're
off,
saying he volunteered right. to be a hostage.
Exactly.
He's actually now, my understanding is that they're going to appeal the dishonorable discharge, which he received as part of the sentence.
I think it's absolutely insane that anybody could look at Sergeant Bergdahl's actions and objectively say, well, you know, he was not dishonorable in his conduct. He was certainly dishonorable in his conduct.
And I've heard you say that in the courtroom, you got the sense that people in the courtroom didn't fully understand what it's like to make the kind of sacrifices that people in combat zones, that your team, that you and others are making every day.
That, yes. I felt in one particular instance, there was a Senior Chief Mike Toussaint, who's retired, who was the handler of Remco, the canine that was killed, saving my life and others' lives that night.
Remco alerted your team to the presence of the Taliban, who were right there.
Had the dog not alerted us, we'd probably all be deceased. So there was a point, Senior Chief Toussaint brought Remco's vest to the courtroom and the prosecution entered it as evidence. And I remember Colonel Nance said, you know, what's the purpose of this? And
that's the
prosecutor,
judge.
Major Usher. Right. And Major Oshana said, hey, you know, it's to show that the government lost government property, essentially. And I wanted to speak up really badly. And I looked at Major Oshana and he kind of shook his head like, don't do it. But what I wanted to say was it means a hell of a lot more than the government lost some property. It means that dog saved our lives and then was taken out of the battle for my crew from there on out.
You talked about yourself having a life sentence and others who were injured as well having a life sentence.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, think about Master Sergeant Allen. You know, takes him an hour. His wife, it takes her an hour to get him out of his bed. So essentially, Master Sergeant Allen has a life sentence. He can't speak. He can't interact with his family. His wife has a life sentence. His children have a life sentence. You know, Specialist Morita, who was hit in the hand with a rocket-propelled grenade, can't use his hand. You know, that's a life sentence.
I was just reading online an article, and you were talking about that you actually met, you actually shook hands with the attorney for Bergdahl, and you actually thanked him for what he was doing. The line you said was, I found it really powerful. And I don't want to misquote it, but it was something. Do you remember what you said to him?
I wanted those guys to know that I was grateful for them representing him, in spite of the fact that I definitely dislike their client. They take the Constitution seriously, and they wanted to do their best for him. And I said thank you for that. And then as it was Mr. Fidel, his civilian representation. As I walked away, Mr. Fidel looked at me and he motioned for me to come over to him. He put his arm around me and quietly, because we're in a hotel lobby, he said, "Hey man, your fly's undone." So it's hard to hate a guy like that, you know?
But I mean, I think that, I don't know. I'm not sure I would have the strength of character that you have to go up to the person defending this person and thank him for, you know, doing something which is constitutionally mandated.
I don't know that it's strength of character. I guess I just feel like this is a crazy time we live in, and there's, you know, Twitter tacticians and comment section commandos. You know, I think the legal system that we have, while flawed, certainly, I think it's important to recognize that even with Sergeant Bergdahl, somebody who obviously I don't have any great positive feelings for, you know, he was represented. He's an American and he deserves his day in court, so to speak. I may not be happy with, you know, Colonel Nance's decision, but I didn't see all the evidence and I don't know what's going on in his head, but I'm an American too, and I can say, hey man, I think it should have been a lot more severe.
Is there anything else you want to say, Jimmy?
I think that the cultural discussion around this type of thing is unfortunate, and I wish that we collectively, you know, there's very few Americans are out in gunfights on the regular, and a lot of people like to comment on what that means, but I think there should be a little respect for it, I guess.
Jimmy Hatch, I appreciate you being with us. Thank you.
Thanks, Anderson.
Footnote, Jimmy has a book coming out about his nearly 25 years in military service, including how he was wounded in the search for Bo Bergdahl. It's called Touching the Dragon and Other Techniques for Surviving Life's Wars. It's going to be published in May. And if you'd like to help him purchase life-saving ballistic vests for police dogs around this country, check out his organization, SpikesCanineFund.org. They do a lot of great work. Up next, President Trump arriving in Hawaii, the first stop before he heads to Asia. He can't escape the Russia probe cloud. We'll get a live report from Honolulu.
Anderson Cooper 360, brought to you by Taltz.
When you're close to the people you love, does psoriasis ever get in the way of a touching moment? If you have moderate to severe psoriasis, you can embrace the chance of completely clear skin with Taltz. Taltz is proven to give you a chance at completely clear skin. With Taltz, up to 90% of patients had a significant improvement of their psoriasis plaques. In fact, 4 out of 10 even achieved completely clear skin. Do not use if you are allergic to Taltz. Before starting, you should be checked for tuberculosis. Taltz may increase your risk of infections and lower your ability to fight them. Tell your doctor if you are being treated for an infection or have symptoms, or if you have received a vaccine or plan to. Symptoms can occur. Now's your chance at completely clear skin. Just ask your doctor about Taltz.
What if I told you there's a place that's not only beautiful, but is actually good for your well-being? I'm a neuroscientist, fascinated with the interaction between the human mind and body. I've come to Costa Rica to explore what it is about this unique country that is bringing happiness to all who visit. In life, we make choices that define what type of life we want and who we want to be. Costa Rica, my choice, naturally.
Big news from Advil. Advil Liquigel is minis, our first concentrated pill that rushes powerful relief. A small new size that's fast because it's liquid. You'll ask, what pain? New Advil Liquigel's minis.
We begin the hour with a late development in the Russian investigation. One of the president's closest former aides, a longtime friend, will be testifying before the House Intelligence Committee, and we're joined in a moment by one of the congressmen who will be questioning him. It comes at the end of a landmark week, one guilty plea, two indictments, new insight into contact during the campaign with Russians, and some hints, at least, of the strategy that Special Counsel Mueller may be following for the investigation. The president has just landed in Hawaii on the way to Japan, the first stop in a marathon tour of East Asia. Before he left, he again called for the Justice Department, his Justice Department, to investigate the rival he defeated.
I'm really not involved with the Justice Department. I'd like to let it run itself. But honestly, they should be looking at the Democrats. They should be looking at Podesta and all of that dishonesty. They should be looking at a lot of things. And a lot of people are disappointed in the Justice Department, including me.
He also said he had no memory of the meeting in March of last year with his foreign policy advisory panel at which George Papadopoulos pitched a meeting with Vladimir Putin. Joining us now is Congressman Jim Himes of Connecticut, a member of the House Intelligence Committee. In terms of where we are tonight, I'm at the end of this pretty incredible week. Is there any more clarity on where this investigation is going in your mind?
Well, the main thing there is that there's new energy in the investigation, right? So if you think back to just 10 days ago, my Republican colleagues were already talking about trying to shut down the investigation because there wasn't enough there. Now, this is despite Don Jr.'s meeting, the firing of Michael Flynn, all that we know. Then, of course, the bombshell lands about George Papadopoulos. And here's a guy who is pleading guilty, admitting to lying about contacts he had with the Russians for the purpose of helping Donald Trump. So let's just, that of course raises all kinds of questions about exactly what happened there, what the follow-up was, but it certainly gives new energy to all of the investigations in terms of finding out what happened.
In terms of the investigation, though, I mean, we're really only seeing the little tip of the iceberg here.
Well, that's right. I mean, and give Bob Mueller his due. He's kept that very much under wraps. We didn't know until until Paul Manafort walked into the courthouse and until the FBI released the George Papadopoulos plea, what was happening.
Was Papadopoulos somebody who was on your radar?
Well, interestingly enough, he was on our radar. And in fact, we had wanted to interview him and we ended up not interviewing him. And that may have been very deliberate on the part of the Department of Justice saying, hey, don't.
Because he may have already been cooperating at that point.
He was certainly cooperating at that point because he's been cooperating for months, which of course is points us to chapter two here. That along with the fact that there are sealed indictments still at DOJ, the fact that presumably now Paul Manafort, now that he knows what he's been charged with, has an incentive to come totally clean, something that the administration has not done to date, to come totally clean about his contacts with the Russians, if any. And of course, the president wasn't wrong when he said Paul Manafort's commercial dealings don't necessarily point to the campaign, but this guy has a long track record of working with pro-Russian entities and people in Ukraine. So we're going to want to know whether there was any follow-on.
We learned yesterday Carter Page, who gave hours of testimony, apparently had told the committee that he had mentioned to Jeff Sessions at a meeting in passing that he was going to go to Russia. Are you willing to cut Jeff Sessions slack that this might have been just something said in passing and not something he should have remembered in his multiple testimonies?
Well, having been in the room when Carter Page said that, I'll tell you, being in a room with Carter Page is really something. When the transcript comes out, because unusually for these depositions, the transcript will be out.
I've interviewed him. It's among the more unusual experiences.
It really is. And the fact that he would come before a congressional inquiry without a lawyer and to speak as freely as he did was really pretty
remarkable. It went on, for my understanding, for almost 6 hours.
Or more. Yeah, no, he was there pretty much all day.
And he didn't have an attorney.
He did not have an attorney. He sort of tried to play one on TV, and I would not, having sat through that for 7 hours, I would not recommend that anybody do that. The transcript will be interesting in that regard. But to answer your question, just given the nature of Carter Page and given the nature of these kinds of receptions where you meet people, it's quite possible that there was a quick exchange. Still, somebody who is a United States senator, who is a senior guy on a campaign, when they are sort of speaking about any sort of contacts, it probably pays to be a good deal more careful than Jeff Sessions ever was on this stuff.
As far as Jared Kushner and Donald Trump Jr. are concerned, do you think you're getting close to figuring out how they fit into all of this, if at all?
Well, I think so. And one of the other witnesses that we interviewed this week was one of the Russian individuals who was in that room. And again, respecting this process as we try to do, I don't want to get into the details of what was said. But yes, this was the first time that that at least on the House side, we got a first person account of what occurred in Trump Tower when Don Jr. had that infamous meeting to try to get dirt on the Clinton administration. Mm.
Congressman Himes, appreciate your time.
Thanks
very much. Joining us now is Ryan Nobles, who's covering the president in Hawaii. Ryan, the president arrived a short time ago. What did he have to say?
Well, he spoke briefly with reporters on Air Force One, Anderson, and he described this trip to the Asia-Pacific region as very important. He talked about the fact that they've altered his schedule a little bit. He's going to stay an extra day in the Philippines for the East Asia Summit, originally planning on only spending one day there. He described the second day as the more important day to reporters, and that's part of why he decided he was going to stay a little bit longer. He also told reporters that he will represent the citizens of the United States well. And he also reminded reporters that he's going to be spending quite a bit of time with them over the next couple of weeks. But this is a very important trip for the president. He currently meeting with the Pacific Command right now, getting a briefing from them about what's happening in the region. Then he will tour the USS Arizona at Pearl Harbor and meet with veterans there. He will head to Tokyo tomorrow to begin this Asia trip. Anderson?
The White House in the past has you know, seems to have been pleased by the president's past foreign trips. They feel he's benefited from those trips. In that sense, in some ways, it could possibly distract from a domestic news cycle. Is there expectation that will happen this time? I mean, obviously, this is a very important trip for this president.
You would think, Anderson, and the president has performed pretty well on these foreign trips in the past, but leading up to this particular trip, he hasn't spent a whole lot of time talking about it. Instead, talking about the Democrats, talking about Hillary Clinton, talking about an election that's already taken place, and spent very little time talking about this particular trip. That could change now that he's actually on the trip and he's going to be meeting with some of these very important foreign leaders, particularly when it comes to this issue of North Korea. This is something that the administration ranks as one of his top priorities. He's going to be meeting with a number of the leaders in this region that are key top priorities. He's going to be meeting with a number of the leaders in this region that are key to this particular issue, leaders from China, South Korea, and Japan. So the White House is hopeful that the president will walk away from this trip with some success, some measurable goals that they can point to show that this trip was worth it for the American people.
Ryan Nobles, thanks very much. Appreciate that. I want to bring in the panel, Abby Phillips, Alice Stewart, Congressman Hakeem Jeffries, Brian Lanza, Jeffrey Toobin, and Michael Zeldin. Jeff, we've learned Keith Schiller is going to be testifying. This is somebody who obviously has been with not only President Trump since the beginning, but with Donald Trump when he was a citizen for a very, very long period of time.
He's what's known as the body person. I mean, he is the person who was with a candidate, real estate developer Donald Trump, and then President Trump for the first several months of his presidency. So to the extent that the investigators want to know who was in the room, he's going to be an excellent source for that. And he will also testify about what he overheard, because there's nothing privileged about anything he heard. So he is going to be a very serious, important.
But I mean, this is somebody who's obviously very close to President Trump. I mean, he has to tell the truth, or else if anything he says is contradicted, there's problems. But
right.
It's got to be difficult for somebody who's been so close to somebody to then testify.
Absolutely. But this week of all weeks, the week of George Papadopoulos, is a week that you are reminded that lying to the FBI is a crime, and one that Robert Mueller is highly willing to prosecute. So, you know, if you're inclined to shade things in one direction or the other, I think the Papadopoulos example is probably going to, it should steer you straight.
Michael, somebody who knows Robert Mueller, used to work with him. Do you expect Mueller would want to talk to Keith Schiller?
Yes, and Hope Hicks and Josh Raphael, who was the communications director for Jared Kushner. He's going to want to talk to everybody in that inner circle. We're moving in. We started with people who are no longer in the White House. Now we're going to people sort of in the White House. Then we're going to get to the key players like Trump eventually and Kushner, and they'll be under oath and they'll have to tell the truth.
And what all these people will certainly be asked about is the talking points, the setup for the response when Donald Trump Jr.'s meeting in June of last year was disclosed, because Mueller is obviously interested in whether a false story was put out.
At Air Force, we've got to take a quick break. We'll continue with the rest of the panel. Also later, have someone at Twitter pull the plug on the president's Twitter account, and exactly what happened with that, we'll explain ahead.
Friday nights on Anderson Cooper 360 are sponsored by Hainan Airlines. Fly your dreams.
Hainan Airlines is bringing the Chongqing Three Gorges and the incredibly adorable Chengdu pandas closer to the Big Apple. With twice weekly non-stop flights from New York to Chongqing and New York to Chengdu, travelers can expect faster, direct access between North America and Central China. Fly your dreams on the five-star premium Hainan Airlines.
Most American homeowners would be shocked if they knew just how rich they were. The average American home value has increased $40,000 over the last 5 years, but many don't know you can access that money without refinancing or selling your home. With a home equity loan, you can pull cash out of your house for anything you need. Home improvement, college tuition, even finally getting out of credit card debt. Come to LendingTree.com to shop and compare home equity loans right now. Because at LendingTree, when banks compete, you win.
Who says you can't give yourself a gift for the holidays? Treat yourself with deals like a D'Angelico EXL 1 Hollow Body, $5.99, or Ernie Ball Cobalt Strings, buy one, get one free. This holiday season, find your sound at Guitar Center.
When I was a Navy SEAL, I trained as hard as I could to stay alive. I have more than 30 pieces of shrapnel still in my leg, but I still push myself to the limit. If it weren't for my Tempur-Pedic, I wouldn't be able to sleep on my left side at all.
The Tempur-Pedic Veterans Day Savings Event is here, and now's the time to take advantage of this incredible offer. Save up to $500 instantly. Find your exclusive retailer today at Tempur-Pedic.com.
Today's Best Western is more rewarding than ever. Rewards members get our best rates and points that never expire. Fast forward to a free night by earning double rewards points with every stay. Go get rewarded. Book now at BestWestern.com.
Today, innovation in the Finger Lakes is helping build the new New York. Once home to the world's image center, New York State is now a leader in optics, photonics, and imaging. Fueled by strong university partnerships, providing the world's best talent, and supported with workforce development to create even more opportunities. All across New York State, we're building the new New York. To grow your business with us in New York State, visit esd.ny.gov.
Welcome to the outside. You don't need a passport to come here or a membership to belong here. Just step outside and you've arrived. Because on the inside, we're all outsiders. And if it's outside, we're all in. L.L. Bean, be an outsider.
So what do you guys do with your closet space now that you rent the runway?
My kids started a closet band. I have my own boot camp.
My closet is open for business.
I rock out in mine. Who needs a closet full of clothes when you can rent the runway? Endless styles, infinite possibilities.
Talking about a landmark week in the Russia investigation, as well as the president's wish to have some kind of Clinton uranium DNC investigation instead. No agree or disagree with the basis for it. It certainly speaks to the White House strategy for getting through the week and perhaps the weeks to come. Back now with the panel. Congressman Jeffries, obviously, you're not on the Intel Committee. You're on the Judiciary Committee. At this point, what are the kind of the major outstanding issues that you would like answers to that most interest you?
Well, what's clear is we've got 17 different intelligence agencies that have concluded that Russia interfered with the election for the purpose of electing Donald Trump. We also know that at the same time that Russia was attacking our democracy, several high-level associates of Donald Trump seem to be in regular communication with these Russian spies. We also know that these Donald Trump allies and associates, folks like Paul Manafort or Donald Trump Jr. or Jared Kushner or Jeff Sessions or Michael Flynn, all were untruthful about their contacts with Russia. And so the real question is just one big coincidence, or is there something more insidious that was involved? And the American people deserve answers to those questions. I'm confident that Bob Mueller will get to the bottom of it, but you have to wonder, Anderson, why were so many folks closely associated with Donald Trump disingenuous, less than forthcoming about their communications with these Russian individuals when Russia was attacking our democracy?
Brian, do you think it's fair to say that?
You know, let me first correct one statement. You have 17 agencies that said that Russia attempted to influence our election. They didn't actually say they influenced a single vote. So I think it's very important that we're clear with that.
Right. And I did say that they interfered with our democracy.
They absolutely did.
To alter the result and to elect Donald Trump. That was the premise of the interference.
They certainly attempted. And I think it's up to the debate if that attempt was effective. Now, what we know is, you know, as this investigation goes forward, I'm of a different opinion. I think it's actually coming close to an end. You're now getting towards the president's inner circle. You start on the outside and you go in. You now have Hope. You now have Keith, who are going to be interviewed when they come back. There's not that many more people for Mueller to interview going forward. There's not 20 years of documents for Mueller to review. You're talking about a year and a half span of a 6 month span of documents from the campaign, a year and a half span of documents between.
You think he's only focused on campaign?
No, I think he's probably probably focus on obstruction of justice as well. But I think, you know, if nothing took place in the campaign, obstruction of justice is irrelevant. And there's no injustice that took place if there's no collusion that took place. And we're under, you know, we still look at the facts and we can say there's only been one campaign that hired a foreign national that actually colluded with the Russians, and that's been documented. That was the Clinton campaign. You have a lot of conjecture with what we've done and what people have tried to muddy the waters. But we're getting close to the end, and we feel confident as the end approaches that there's going to be no demonstration that any collusion took
Michael,
place.
Michael, is this the beginning of the end?
No, I don't think so. Maybe the end of the beginning, but I think that there are three broad areas that Mueller's got. One is financial crime generally, and Manafort represented the first step in that.
And that's you're talking about not campaign-related, even going back, I mean...
Correct.
However,
so you've
long.
Got Manafort representing step one in that. Probably Flynn in step two of that. Then they're going to look at the Trump business empire and the Kushner business empire and Cohen. So I think that there are lots of pure financial crime stuff, maybe connected, maybe disconnected. Then you've got obstruction of justice. That's its own sort of work stream. And that's what I think Hope Hicks and these guys are relevant to. And then you've got the broader conspiracy to interfere with the federal election and conspiracy to acquire and disseminate stolen computer-based information. That's the Analytica stuff and the Roger Stone stuff and the Peter Smith stuff and all that stuff that still hasn't been clearly analyzed in Mueller's sort of determination about whether or not a crime has been committed. So I think that's wishful thinking. And maybe on the pure, simple collusion point, maybe they're closer. But
Alice, do you see it toward the ending?
I think we're just beginning to scratch the surface. I think I agree with Jeffrey. What Mueller did intentionally with the charge against George Papadopoulos was, look, you can't lie to me. You're not going to get away with providing false statements. And as the inner circle gets closer and they start to be questioned, they understand Mueller's serious when he's asking these questions and he wants them to be truthful. I think it's important we're following the money trail now, things that happened before the campaign. But the real crux of what a lot of people are focused on is Russian collusion. And that's where we need to find out in that meeting back in March. What did George P. have the authority to do? Did the president go along with it? But here's what we do know happened. I've talked with J.D. Gordon. He was in that meeting, and he has said, look, this young kid who was on the foreign policy team, he brought this up, tried to suggest a meeting between the president and Vladimir Putin. Jeff Sessions says absolutely not. That was shut down. It never came up again. But he took upon himself to go around their backs and go to other people within the campaign and try to get this going. So right now what we're seeing is younger people, they were not volunteers. These were unpaid people that were advisors on the foreign policy team between George P. and Carter Page. But who gave them the authority to move forward with these conversations? That's the question. That's the crux of whether or not there's any kind of Russian collusion. Right now, I just don't see it.
Abby?
I think one of the most fascinating questions about George Papadopoulos is why he was kept in the campaign circle even while he was freelancing and doing all of this stuff. I think that's a really important unanswered question, the fact that he was working with federal investigators for 3 months after his arrest is also an important data point. And I think we should remember the May 5th or the May 7th trial date is pretty far from now. It's about 7 months into the future. A lot is going to happen in that time. And I think that, you know, contrary to Brian's hope, I don't think this, I think Alice is right. This is not the end. This is just the beginning because we have a lot of investigation that's left. And frankly, I don't think that the Mueller team has been leaking profusely about what's going on. We didn't know who was being indicted until Monday morning. And so there's likely a lot of investigation happening. We don't know how cooperative Papadopoulos was with the investigators. And there are others, people like Carter Page, who seem very eager to talk to any and everybody.
Well, that's an understatement. but Michael, you think it's actually possible that Flynn has been flipped?
He's been quiet for a long time. Yeah. And he has, I think, and Jeffrey can tell me if I got it right or wrong, he's got very similar problems to Manafort, except the source of his funds is from Turkey. And I think that if he looks at the Manafort indictment, then he says, I didn't do right by my FARA registration. I have the additional failure to do my SF-86 financial disclosure form correctly. I have income that I probably didn't declare on my taxes, and I may have FBAR issues for accounts held overseas more than $10,000.
And he has a son who's also in the crosshairs.
And the reason that he has the imperative to cooperate is he's got a son.
All right, we've got to take a quick break. Much more to talk about. We're actually getting some breaking news right now. New information about what Carter Page told the House Intelligence Committee behind closed doors. That is next.
What is life? Life is about love.
I've always been a polygamist, and I didn't know it.
However unconventional it may be.
People will say it's crazy, loving another man who's married.
Had you ever gone on a blind date with two women before?
No, they're the first couple I've dated.
If you're into it for sex, you are into it for the wrong reasons, and it's not going to last.
This is Life with Lisa Lang, Sunday night at 10 on CNN.
All right is in the water. All right is in the air. All right says I do. All right says I dare. All right is how you'll feel, because all right flows here, only in Jamaica, the home of all right.
Publishers Clearing House is ready to award the new Turn Back Time Prize. 10 years of back payments right away. That's $2.6 million. Then $5,000 a week for life. Don't miss your last chance to win. Enter at PCH.com now on December 22nd. It could be you.
Hello. Let's go for a ride on a Peloton. Let's go grab a couple thousand friends and chase each other up a hill. Let's go make a personal best, then beat it with your personal better than best. Let's go bring the world's best instructors right to you. Better yet, let's go bring the entire New York studio live. Let's go anytime, anywhere, with anyone who's willing. And let's go do it all right here. Ready to go? Peloton.
DirecTV has been rated number one in customer satisfaction over cable for 17 years running. But some people still like cable. Just like some people like banging their head on a low ceiling. Drinking spoiled milk. Camping in poison ivy. Getting a paper cut. And having their arm trapped in a vending machine. But for everyone else, there's DirecTV. For number one rated customer satisfaction over cable, switch to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
Eras, they're defined by accomplishments, by victories, by those with the resourcefulness, the ingenuity, and the grit to help ensure the next energy to power our dreams will be American Energy. This is our era. This is America's energy era. Next Era Energy.
Join Bill Weir on a journey through New Zealand and see what's being done to protect the country's national symbol, the kiwi.
Dropping poison from the skies. What do you say to the folks who have a problem with that?
The Wonderlist with Bill Weir, tomorrow at 9 on CNN.
If you're struggling with at least $10,000 in credit card debt, you could qualify for National Debt Relief's Debt Reset Program. Some pocket expenses. Imagine being debt-free in 24 to 48 months. Call now to see if you qualify. You can talk to a counselor right now.
Call 800-685-1205.
We know our customers have busy lives. That's why we're working hard to improve our customer service. The whole culture of the company is shifting towards customer service. Now with Xfinity My Account, you can pay your bill right from your phone and easily add premium channels. You can even change your Wi-Fi password to something that's easy to remember. We're doing everything we can to give you the best experience possible. I'm Kieran from Comcast. We should fit into your life, not the other way around.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
We've got breaking news on what Carter Page told the House Intelligence Committee. The New York Times has it. Joining us now by phone is Time correspondent Mark Mazzetti, who shares the byline. Mark, this is significant because Carter Page has always denied in public interviews that he met with government officials in Russia. What's your reporting?
We're reporting that he told the House Intelligence Committee yesterday that he indeed did meet with Russian government officials. This was after repeated questions that were posed to him by the committee, and that he met them during his July 2016 trip to Moscow. As you pointed out, he's done numerous interviews, including with your show, with the New York Times, but he's never admitted to having any direct contact with Russian government officials.
Right. He always says basically he was flown there, I think, on economy seats by this university in order to give the commencement I think it was a commencement address at this Russian university, and that he really only met with scholars. So that this would be a pretty significant change in his story if he's now saying, oh, yeah. I mean, there was always questions like, well, are, you know, a scholar in Russia, is that somebody who may be somebody who has connections with the Kremlin or intelligence services? But he now has said to the committee that he did, in fact, meet with, was it more than one government official? Do you know?
It's unclear. When I spoke to him earlier today, he did indicate that there was more than one official, and including one who was, he said, senior, but identities are still unknown. Some of this emerged during the committee hearing yesterday when he was presented with an email he had given sent to the campaign after the trip, sort of saying that he had meetings with officials and government, business executives and legislators. And these were sort of his insights from the trip. So this came in partly because of production and email in the course of the investigation.
Do you know who he had sent the email to in the Trump campaign after the trip?
We don't know that yet.
Okay, because my memory, and this is just from my memory of my last strange interview with him, was he had said, I think he had said that Corey Lewandowski or somebody on the campaign had asked for permission if it was okay to go, and he'd been given permission as long as he wasn't representing himself as part of the campaign.
Right, and there's been a lot of scrutiny of this trip and a lot of different stories about the trip, and it's been really unclear to, it's been hard to pin down exactly what happened and who he met and what became of it. And so I think this was significant because it is the first time that he is acknowledging that he did meet with Russian officials, but there's obviously still more to learn.
Mark Mazzetti, I appreciate the reporting. It's fascinating. Another detail back now with the panel. Jeff?
Can we just step back and ask how many members of the Trump campaign met with representatives of the Russian government? George Papadopoulos, Carter Page, Donald Trump Jr., Jared Kushner, Paul Manafort, Jeff Sessions. What's going on? And when, as Congressman Jeffries just pointed out, when asked about it, virtually all of them, let's charitably say, dissembled. Why were they all meeting with Russians? Why did they all not tell the truth when asked about it?
Congressman Jeffries is...
Yeah, so Jeffrey is exactly right. I mean, the legal process will run its course, but the average American can reasonably ask the question, why were so many high-level members and associates of the Trump campaign meeting with Russian governmental officials at the same time they were attacking our democracy and then lied about it? And let's take a step back and catalog the individuals who were involved. Paul Manafort, the campaign chairman, Michael Flynn, the national security advisor, Jeff Sessions, the attorney general, Donald Trump Jr., the son, Jared Kushner, the son-in-law, Carter Page, a foreign policy advisor, and of course, there's the ever-lovable Roger Stone, who was involved in a variety of different ways in telegraphing that something was coming at the Clinton campaign. These are all extremely close Trump associates who've been disingenuous about their communication when Donald Trump continues to maintain nothing happened. It's all a hoax.
Well, Michael,
so why can't they just come clean?
But Mike, I mean, is it possible, I mean, you and I have talked about this before, that there is another explanation to this? I mean, again, this is all just that. I think you and I have talked about this, the idea that Trump didn't expect to win and was looking for possible future business dealings, and Jared Kushner and Manafort also had financial interests in maintaining contacts with Russia, that a lot of these people had, Carter Page, you could argue as well, I guess George Papadopoulos as well, would have had some sort of, even if he wasn't going to become president, it wouldn't have hurt to continue business in Russia.
Yeah, I think actually at the outset, a lot of the outreach to Russia was business-driven. Trump wanting his hotel and Trump getting money from Russians when no one else would lend money to him. Don Jr. gave a speech saying in their high-end properties in New York, Russians were their source of funding. They have a lot of Russian oligarchs living in Trump Tower. I think there was a financial motive that a lot of these people have. Manafort had a financial motive. Flynn had a financial motive. And I thought then, perhaps, as we moved into March, April, May, June, in this key summer period, when things are looking a little bit better for them, they're thinking, well, maybe we have a chance here. What is our sort of October surprise? What is it that we can do that'll put us over the top that can't be responded to? And I think dirt in order to take them politically where they didn't think they'd start at the very end of their day.
What you just outlined, there's not evidence for that yet.
No, I mean,
there may yet be.
It's a
but
theory.
Let's just, you know, stick to a certain, like, what the fact, I mean, that's a theory.
That's all I've said.
We're going to continue this discussion when we come back, what Carter Page told me about this very trip when we spoke.
Where's Gary?
Saved money on motorcycle insurance with Geico. Going up the country. Later, Gary.
I have a motorcycle. Wonderful.
Geico Motorcycle. Great rates for great rides.
For Woodford Reserve, quality is what we're judged against. If we aren't great, nothing else matters. Quality. It's our Woodford way.
A passenger was murdered.
And every one of you is a suspect.
The real killer is one of you people.
The train is stuck.
I'm sleeping here, where everyone can see me, and I can see everyone.
Keep your mouth shut.
I didn't do it.
I would not lie.
The world's a cruel place.
Murder on the Orient Express. Rated PG-13.
Call 1-800-SANDALS. Baby, you don't have to say
nothing. Hey, you ever talk to anybody about your money?
Yeah, I got some financial guidance a while ago.
How'd that go?
He kept spelling my name with an I.
But it's Brian with a Y.
Yeah, since birth.
That drives me crazy.
Yes.
It's on all your email.
Yes.
They should know this.
Yeah, the guy was my brother-in-law.
That's ridiculous. Well, I happen to know some people.
Do they listen?
What? They're amazing listeners.
Nice.
Guidance from professionals who take their time to get to know you.
Before the break, you heard a New York Times correspondent talking about Carter Page's testimony before the House Intelligence Committee and how his account of who he met with differed from the one that he's been giving publicly on programs like this one. Listen to what he told me back in March. Let's first start about what you said to Judy Woodruff and then what you said last night in MSNBC. Last month, you said to Judy Woodruff, she asked you, did you have any meetings last year with Russian officials in Russia, outside Russia, anywhere? You said no meetings. You repeated it three times. We just played that. Then all of a sudden last night, you say to Chris Hayes that you, quote, do not deny talking with Russia's U.S. ambassador over the summer at a conference at the Republican convention. That sounds like you were misleading to Judy Woodruff.
You know, Anderson, a great analogy is you and I were members of the same health club here in New York previously. And I remember walking by you, even though we didn't know each other. Mm. And I said, hi, Anderson. And you said hello. And we, you know, a nice little exchange for half a second. Mm. Now, does that to you constitute a meeting?
Well, I guess we've met, but it's not a meeting.
Exactly. Thanks a lot. So, I mean, I will not talk about anything that happened in off-the-record meetings. There's plenty of people in Washington I know nowadays,
right, but
especially
who
kind of...
When Judy said, did you have any meetings last year with Russian officials in Russia, outside Russia, you could have just said, well, I did attend a conference and was in a meeting with the Russian ambassador at the Republican National Convention. Because that sounds like more than just saying hello to him.
It was literally, you know, the amount of time you and I walked by each other and, you know, greeted each other.
You're saying
it's about, again, I don't talk about off-the-record confidential information.
I think the public has a right to know about this health club meeting.
I was not even aware of this health club meeting. Apparently he had introduced himself to me once. Did not know that. But what the reporting is, that was about a meeting during the summer at the conventions. This is what he's now testified to and what he had denied on that same broadcast, was that in his trip to Russia, he had only met with scholars, with professors, with not with government people. He's now, according to the reporting by the New York Times, has told that, in fact, he did meet with some government people.
I mean, this is the kind of thing that makes the White House nervous, or at least ought to make some people in the White House nervous. When they see public things happen and it doesn't hit them directly, some of them say, oh, it's fine. Like, Paul Manafort, you know, that's not related to campaign activity. But then Carter Page goes into, you know, a sworn testimony environment and says something completely different from what he has been saying in the public. And that's where the danger zone is in this situation. You have people who are going into, you know, they are being sworn to tell the truth and they don't want to go to jail. So they're going to tell the truth.
Well, the key part, too, also, is that he was presented, apparently, by the House committee with an email that he had sent back to the campaign describing who he had met with and what his perception
of it all was. Right, and who that person was still remains to be seen. But he did, as you know, and you've said, ask permission to go. And they said, you can't go as someone from the campaign, but feel free to go. And the concern for him, and I think the overall Trump team should be, in this New York Times article, they say he has spoken with the FBI, he has appeared before the grand jury. Has his story changed? Did he tell them the same thing he told this House committee this week? If his story has changed that significantly, we're going to have a George P. number two, and that's just not a good situation to be in. And if his story has changed, then I don't see any other outcome for him.
Does it matter if, I mean, Carter Page, by his own, or I mean, I don't know if it's true or not, this is what he has said in multiple interviews, including me, is that he's never met President Trump. He claimed in a press conference, why he had a press conference in Moscow, I'm not clear, but apparently there were reporters asking him questions, clearly as a, because he was a campaign advisor, that he had been in meetings with Donald Trump. He then now claims that his he was using the term meetings in the Russian definition of the term meeting, meaning he went to, I think, a rally that the president spoke at. So he was in a auditorium with tens of thousands of other people, and he was calling that being in a meeting with the candidate.
Oh, that's what I call a meeting, too. So, I went to a meeting with the New York Mets this summer.
So I was
like, during the game, but I was, like, in the...
Yeah. I mean, it is equivalent.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, evidently, y'all had a meeting at the gym. So I think...
I think what's important is you know, we're going to speculate, you know, who he communicated with, but what we do know from this testimony is that it appears that he's telling the truth. And I think that's an example to everybody else who's going to go before any investigation that they be as transparent as truthful as possible.
That's the... You got the impression from Carter Page that he was telling the truth?
In this article.
In the testimony. Article,
the testimony. You mean the latest version? And you think this is the final
version? Well, this is under
oath. Oh, you mean Judy Woodruff is not under oath and Anderson is not under
oath? He's only responsible for what he said to the Congressional Committee.
If anyone actually believes that we have heard the last and final version of Carter Page, I think you are not paying full attention.
Right. He's the meaning of is person in this campaign.
Way to bring up Bill Clinton.
He keeps changing what a meeting is and who he's met with.
All right, we're
going to take a break. He learned from Bill Clinton?
Could have.
We're going to take a quick break. Much more ahead when we come back. New details tonight on the former DNC's DNC chair's claim that the Democratic primary election was rigged. We'll hear from the Clinton campaign manager, Robbie Mook, next.
You're searching for something like the perfect deal on the perfect hotel. So wouldn't it be perfect if there was a single site where you could find the right hotel for you at the best price? There is, because TripAdvisor now compares prices from over 200 booking sites to save you up to 30% on the hotel you want. Trust this bird's words. TripAdvisor, the latest reviews, the lowest prices.
For a limited time only at VisionWorks, get two complete pairs of single vision glasses for $49 or two complete pairs of progressives for $89, plus 25% off all lens upgrades. Only at VisionWorks.
Publishers Clearing House is ready to award the new Turn Back Time Prize. 10 years of back payments right away. That's $2.6 million. Then $5,000 a week for life. Don't miss your last chance to win. Enter at PCH.com now on December 22nd. It could be you.
Everyone deserves attention, whether you've saved a lot or just a little.
At PNC Investments, we believe you're more than just a number. So we provide personal financial advice for every retirement investor.
This is an apple. Some people might try to tell you that it's a banana. They might scream, banana. You might even start to believe that this is a banana. But it's not. This is an apple.
Mr. Murphy, are there other taxes you would raise?
The answer is yes.
Higher income taxes, higher property taxes, higher business taxes, higher sales taxes, a plan to raise them all.
It's a ton of money.
If Goldman Sachs multimillionaire Phil Murphy gets elected, he'll be the only one who can afford to stay here. Kim Guadagno is better. Kim's plan finally cuts property taxes. Real relief for real families. A more affordable New Jersey. Kim Guadagno, better.
You have to be true to who you've been all season and do what got you there.
He's battled back, and he has once again shown his dominance.
We've already shown that we can win.
Keselowski's going to win at Talladega.
I think this could be the year for us.
You don't get to be the best by being the nice guy.
I feel like I've already done the impossible.
Make room, Richard Petty and Dale Earnhardt. There's another seven-time champ.
All-new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico, Sunday at 9 on CNN.
Tonight we're learning new details on claims that the Democratic primary was rigged in Hillary Clinton's favor. Now this all stems from former DNC chair Donna Brazile's new book. In an excerpt released yesterday, she accuses the DNC and Clinton's campaign of entering into an unethical fundraising agreement that benefited Clinton. Tonight CNN obtained a copy of that fundraising agreement. The document does not give the Clinton campaign outright authority to make staffing decisions for the DNC, but does give her a say in some positions. As all this news was breaking tonight, I spoke to Clinton's former campaign manager, Robbie Mook, who spoke out for the first time since the allegations came to light. Here's part of what he said. Memo says your campaign got to weigh in on who the communications director was before the general election. Was that fair?
Well, first of all, Anderson, I just want to underscore some things Brianna said. First of all, when the DNC approached both campaigns about a joint fundraising agreement, they were broke. They weren't going to make payroll. They were not going to be able to transfer down money to the state parties to keep them operational. They were in a really bad place. Both the Sanders campaign and the Clinton campaign signed joint fundraising agreements. So we both thought it was a good thing to sign up for. The only difference was Sanders didn't raise any money in, and we did.
My understanding is that communications position actually had to be filled even before the primary races.
Well, that's correct. I mean, this is a perfect example.
So that wasn't just about the general election, right?
Well, no, but it absolutely is. The purpose of the DNC while a primary is going on is to hold Republican candidates accountable. And there was nobody filling that post. It was a big problem. It was something that any Democrat should have been worried about. That's why if you look in that memo, we explicitly set a date whereby they have to hire someone because we were distressed that there was no lead voice out there speaking out against Donald Trump and Ted Cruz and everybody else.
But clearly, Jeff Weaver and the Sanders campaign believed that things were rigged against them.
Well, here's what I'll say about this. You know, politics is politics. People have to go there, you know, go out there and say what they need to say. I think it's dangerous to say that this contest was rigged for the following reason.
Because Elizabeth Warren, by the way, is also saying that now.
Well, and Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders are important members of our party. They're an important part of our politics. We can't make the case to working people in this country that we're going to stand up for them and we're going to fight for them if we're fighting each other. We can't do that. Hillary Clinton won this primary with almost 4 million votes. That's a bigger lead than Barack Obama had over her when she lost and conceded in 2008. The idea that the DNC could rig a contest, frankly, is laughable. And here's the last thing I'll say. You know, the caucus contests within the larger primary are the contests that are run by the party. You know, the primary elections are run by secretaries of state. Those contests, the caucuses that were run by the party, Bernie Sanders won overwhelmingly. So if we look at what the party actually managed in this process, Bernie Sanders won those contests. I think we only won three of them, and we barely won Iowa. So there's just no evidence to back this up. I understand how it's convenient. Some people like, you know, they want to be angry at what's going on.
Back now with the panel. Abby, what do you make of?
I think this is, I covered Hillary in the campaign, and this is an issue that has dogged her for a long time. I think that you kind of have to separate a couple of things here. There is this document that Donna Brazile referenced, which is not exactly as she characterized it, and it does give the Clinton campaign certain abilities to make certain demands. But I actually think the more important thing is the money. The reason that document exists is because the Clinton campaign said, yes, we are going to fund the DNC through these joint committees, and Bernie had a joint committee but didn't use it. The Clinton campaign did, and that gave them a lot of power over the institution. I don't think the document itself really tells us much about how that power was wielded. It might have been explicitly, it might have been because they said, oh, we have to hire a communications director. But I think the underlying question that a lot of Bernie Democrats have is, what were the implicit ways in which the Clinton campaign controlled the DNC? Were there efforts of people within the DNC to help bolster her standing in the primaries?
I mean, I got a point, but let me also just point at Donna Brazile. I mean, she's the one who, through somebody who doesn't work at CNN, got access to one town hall question and sent an email, which we know from WikiLeaks, to someone in the Clinton campaign to give them a town hall question, which is completely unethical. She wasn't doing that for Bernie Sanders.
Are we surprised that the Clinton campaign, you know, operated without ethics? They've been doing this their entire
life.
How about a debate? You know, trying to do debates when nobody's paying attention. You know, I mean, these are things that they purposely put their thumb on the scale to help Hillary.
Well, Brian, this is exactly why it's important.
Well, let him finish.
They wanted the votes of the progressives, but they didn't want their voices. But, and I think that's a problem with the Democratic Party.
You know, it's really wonderful to hear Trump campaign officials talk about the voice of progressives needing to be heard, because I know that's something that I know it's very.
We won Michigan, Wisconsin, because we appealed to working class people. We were appealing to those votes, and we were appealing to
Congressman Jeffries.
I think, well, first of all, I've got great respect for Donna Brazile, and she's done a lot for the Democratic Party and for progressive politics over several decades. It's obviously a messy situation in terms of what happened or may have happened in 2016, and we need to figure out what occurred, why it occurred, and how do we prevent it from ever happening again. I think that will be important to try to bring about closure, because we've got too many important issues to tackle on behalf of everyday Americans here in Washington, D.C., and throughout the nation. And we cannot be successful in the midterm elections if we're fighting amongst each other. When we have a president, Donald Trump, that many of us believe is an existential threat to our values.
Does anyone does anyone really believe the DNC did not want Hillary Clinton to be the candidate?
No, that's clear. And look, what we see the takeaway from what Donna has written is that this was an unethical joint fundraising agreement. There were certain stipulations put in there that would help Hillary Clinton that weren't there for Bernie Sanders. But at the end of the day, the reason this was done, the DNC was in bad financial straits. They needed a influx of cash, and Hillary was in a position to do that. And that was how the JFA benefited her. The key is, the takeaway from Donna was that this JFA, the joint fundraising agreement, was unethical, but in no way did the DNC tip their hand on the scales for her. I find that hard to believe. If they're coordinating with fundraising, that is a finger on the scale.
This is the document. This is actually the document. It gives Hillary Clinton the right to participate in the naming of the director of communications for the DNC. Can anyone here at this table name anyone in history who has been the director of communications for the DNC? This is a minor job, an unimportant person, and the fact that she got a voice, not even the chance to name them, but I mean, it's so minor. What advantage did she get from this document?
Just make it clear, the JFA is not in and of itself an unethical agreement. Bernie signed an identical JFA with the DNC. They just didn't use it, so they had no financial leverage over the institution. But I also think there are a lot of Democrats who, throughout the campaign, believed that at the very top, people like Debbie Wasserman Schultz were actually Clinton supporters, wanted her to win. That's a completely separate issue. I think you can litigate that separately. The JFA itself, I think that agreement is in and of itself pretty boilerplate. They've been doing it, and they did it in 2012. Bernie did it in 2016.
So then why does Donna Brazile say that it was the smoke?
I think this is exactly why there are a lot of people raising questions about the conclusion that Donna came to. I think the facts out there you know, it's sort of weird that they would agree to do this, to do the separate agreement, which is not the JFA, by the way, the separate agreement. It's weird that they would agree to do that. But I don't see any connection. I don't see any clear evidence that that separate agreement led to tipping the election. It's just not there.
And I think we have to separate things. So you had the process and what was taking place underneath the roof of the DNC, and that's one thing. But you've got primaries and caucuses in 50 states. And our election rules provide that those primaries and caucuses are largely run on a state-by-state-by-state basis. And there's no evidence that the DNC reached in, artificially shaped the results. Bernie Sanders won some states, Hillary Clinton won more. Bernie Sanders won some caucuses, Hillary Clinton won some caucuses. There's no evidence that there was any outside interference in the actual electoral results.
I just find it funny. I mean, you know, half an hour ago, you were saying that the Russians changed the votes to help it for President Trump.
That's not what I said.
You implied it. Would you not agree?
What I said. No.
You implied it.
There's an ongoing criminal investigation. Yeah. By someone who's well-respected by Democrats, Republicans,
I just think it's funny, they're talking about, you know, there was no votes changed because of this agreement in the Democratic Party. Here's what happened, is the Democratic Party shut out Bernie Sanders voters. You know, the reason Bernie Sanders didn't participate,
they didn't encourage
the debates, they limited the debates.
That doesn't stop anyone from voting.
No, that it discourages participation.
You said shut out them from voting.
No, I said discourage participation.
Because they had a debate on Saturday.
Don't you want access? Don't you want a debate? Don't you want a winning of the policies of ideas, or do you want to have nothing?
If you want to defend the Clinton campaign, you can. I understand that. They absolutely shut down the process for Bernie Sanders voters.
They absolutely did.
By having a debate on Saturday is shutting down the process.
They are limiting who can participate by who's paying attention to the race. We both know that the activity is driven from debates. People are watching debates. They realize there's an election around the corner.
They get more active. Your sympathy for Bernie Sanders voters,
I think it's
so
also
touching.
You got to be fair.
We have Bernie Sanders voters as part of the coalition. We defend their right to
Bernie supporters were always more enthusiastic than Clinton supporters for a vast majority of the campaign.
That's right.
So it's hard for me to believe that that there was some effort to suppress their support for Bernie. I think they were pretty enthusiastic.
And they're also, as the polls went on, the more time she spent away from camera and out of the limelight, her poll numbers went up. The more she was in front of people, her poll numbers went down. So from the DNC standpoint, the less they could put her and him in the spotlight, because he did well when more people saw him, more people warmed up to him, more people wanted to vote for him. They wanted to keep her down.
Coming up, the 11 minutes on Twitter silence heard around the world. The Ridiculous is next.
When I was a Navy SEAL, I trained as hard as I could to stay alive. I have more than 30 pieces of shrapnel still in my leg, but I still push myself to the limit. If it weren't for my Tempur-Pedic, I wouldn't be able to sleep on my left side at all.
The Tempur-Pedic Veterans Day Savings event is here, and now's the time to take advantage of this incredible offer. Save up to $500 instantly on select Tempur-Pedic adjustable mattress sets. Find your exclusive retailer today at Tempur-Pedic.com.
Today's Best Western is more rewarding than ever. Rewards members get our best rates and points that never expire. Fast forward to a free night by earning double rewards points with every stay. Go get rewarded. Book now at BestWestern.com.
Make an entrance with Joseph A. Banks buy one get one free sale on almost everything in store. Plus, all traveler and 1905 suits $249, and all dress shirts, including our best-selling traveler shirt, 2 for $89. The buy one get one free sale only at Joseph A. Bank.
Ron, something's going on at Schwab.
Oh, really? Thank you, clients.
Well, J.D. Power did just rank them highest in investor satisfaction
with full-service brokerage firms.
Again.
And online equity trades only $4.95. I mean, you can't have low cost and be full service.
It's impossible. It's like having your cake and eating it too.
Ask your broker if they offer award-winning full service and low costs.
How am I going to explain this?
If you don't like their answer, ask again at Schwab. Schwab, a modern approach to wealth management.
We opened our doors with 70 megawatts, 35 mules, and an ice plant. But we brought power to the people, redefining what that meant from one era to the next. Over 90 years later, we continue to build as America's third largest investor in infrastructure. We don't just help power the American dream, we're part of it. This is our era. This is America's energy era. Next Era Energy.
This is me when I feel controlled by frequent, unpredictable abdominal pain or discomfort and diarrhea.
I've tried lifestyle changes and over-the-counter treatments, but my symptoms keep coming back. It turns out I have irritable bowel syndrome with diarrhea, or IBS-D, a condition that's really frustrating. That's why I talked to my doctor about Viberzi, a different way to treat IBS-D.
Viberzi is a prescription medication you take every day that helps proactively manage both abdominal pain and diarrhea at the same time.
So I can stay ahead of my symptoms.
Viberzi can cause new or worsening abdominal pain. Do not take Viberzi if you have no gallbladder, have pancreas or severe liver problems, problems with alcohol abuse, long-lasting or severe constipation, or a bowel or gallbladder blockage. Pancreatitis may occur and can lead to hospitalization and death. If you're taking Viberzi, you should not take medicines that cause constipation. The most common side effects of Viberzi include constipation, nausea, and abdominal pain.
For 100 years, heritage and innovation have made Gillette the number one shave in America. Now get Gillette quality at lower prices every day. Brought to you by 1,200 workers in Boston. We're proud of giving you our best. Gillette, the best a man can get.
More quality inclusions than any other resorts on the planet. Save up to 65%. Call 1-800-SANDALS.
Time now for The Ridiculous, and tonight we've got to talk about the 11 minutes last night when people saw this when they tried to check the president's Twitter. Now, Twitter says, quote, through our investigation, we have learned that this was done by a Twitter customer support employee who did this on the employee's last day. We are conducting a full internal review. Now, we don't know much about this employee, anything really, except that he or she kind of went out in a blaze of glory or shame, depending on your political perspective. A lot of people on Twitter drew a parallel to Peggy Olson striding out of the office smoking a cigarette on Mad Men. But we all know the gold standard of quitting with flair is from the movie Office Space.
I thought I remembered you saying that you wanted to express yourself.
Yeah, you know what? Yeah, I do. I do want to express myself. Okay? And I don't need 37 pieces of flair to do it. All right? There's my flair. Okay? And this is me expressing myself. Okay? There it is. I hate this job.
As for spectacular quits in real life, there was, of course, the flight attendant who had finally had it with rude passengers, grabbed a few beers from the beverage cart, deployed the evacuation slide, and slid right on out of there. Then there was the shift manager, one of those KFC Taco Bell hybrids, who quit after being denied the 4th of July off after working 22 straight days. Smiley face, I think, is kind of a nice touch. And who can forget the reporter in Alaska who quit live on the air to pursue her passion of medical marijuana advocacy?
And as for this job, well, not that I have a choice, but it, I quit.
All right, we apologize for that. we'll be right back. Pardon for us.
Wow, that was painful. You can put it bluntly, or you can strike a different note, like this guy who quit his job at a hotel.
Guys, what is this? Guys, all of you out right now.
Jared, I'm here to tell you that I'm quitting.
The live band, that was pretty unique. But it is a long-held truth that music makes everything better, including dancing your way to freedom. Killer, I ride on chrome. Knock, knock, who's there? Killer Cam, killer who?
I quit. Oh yeah, you can take this job, and you know you can take this job.
Quitting that in the middle of the forest. So to the Twitter employee who on your last day did what many thought was impossible, whoever you are, you've earned a spot on the list of all-time quit stories and on The Ridiculous. That does it for us. Time to turn things over to Don Lemon. CNN Tonight starts right now.
This is CNN Tonight. I'm Don Lemon, and this has been a week of one big revelation after another in the Russia investigation. So many that you may have trouble keeping track. through it all, the White House, so denying, deflecting, and distracting here. But don't for a moment lose sight of everything that has happened in just the past 5 days, because the facts do matter here. So let's go through the facts first, okay? Monday morning, we learned that former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort and his deputy Rick Gates were indicted on 12 counts. Their trial proposed for May 2018 on charges including money laundering and improperly filing disclosure forms about foreign lobbying. That surprised virtually no one, but this did. The revelation that back in July, Trump foreign policy advisor George Papadopoulos pleaded guilty to lying to the FBI about his contacts with Russians. Court documents suggest he has been a cooperating witness for months, maybe even wearing a wire. Tuesday, the president takes to Twitter, of course, to try to do damage control. Quote, few people knew the young low-level volunteer named George, who has already proven to be a liar. Check the Dems. But wait, there's more. Today, the president said this about his meeting during the campaign with his own foreign policy advisors, including that so-called low-level volunteer named George.
I don't remember much about that meeting. It was a very unimportant meeting, took place a long time. Don't remember much about it.
Well, in the interest of refreshing the president's memory, according to what he said just 9 days ago, one of the great memories of all times, there's this photo of the meeting, tweeted from his very own account. On Wednesday, we learned that that meeting, the president entertained the possibility of a sit-down with Vladimir Putin, and it was suggested by, wait for it, George Papadopoulos. On Thursday, we learned that Jeff Sessions rejected the meeting idea, but somehow neglected to mention it in multiple congressional hearings. That same day, former Trump foreign policy aide Carter Page says he told Sessions in June of 2016 that he was taking a trip to Russia. But that's not all. We also learned that President Trump's own son-in-law, senior advisor Jared Kushner, has turned over documents to Robert Mueller's team. Other witnesses in the investigation have been asked about Kushner's role in the firing of the FBI director, James Comey. And that brings us to today, Friday. Carter Page telling our very own Jake Tapper that he mentioned that planned trip to Russia to a few people on the campaign. And President Trump says this as he heads out on a trip to Asia.
All I can tell you is this. There was no collusion. There was no nothing. It's a disgrace, frankly, that they continue. You ought to look at Hillary Clinton, and you ought to look at the new book that was just put out by Donna Brazile, where she basically bought the DNC and she stole the election from Bernie. So that's what you ought to take a look at.
There are real questions about Hillary Clinton's relationship with the DNC, questions that we have been covering and will continue to cover. But Hillary Clinton lost the election. She's not the president of the United States. Donald Trump is. And that makes the Russia investigation a matter of national and international importance. Don't let anybody distract you from that. I want to bring in now CNN's chief national security correspondent, Jim Sciutto, CNN political analyst, Margaret Talib, and CNN political commentator, Matt Lewis. Good evening to both of you. To all of you. Thank you for coming on. Jim, the president is heading out of the country right now as things are heating up with the Russia investigation, his administration under pressure. Remember this from back in February?
Can you say whether you are aware that anyone who advised your campaign had contacts with Russia during the course of the election?
Well, I told you, General Flynn obviously was dealing, so that's one person, but he was dealing as he should have been.
During the election?
No, nobody that I know of.
That was an unqualified, Jim, denial there. But the key question after this week, did President Trump and Jeff Sessions mislead about campaign contacts with Russia?
Well, listen, Don, I mean, the Trump world story on their contacts with Russia has changed a number of times, because remember, the initial story was there were no contacts or meetings. They were dismissed out of hand. That has been proven false over time. There is documentation of these meetings, emails, etc. And now you have President Trump himself and others admitting that such meetings took place, but dismissing them as unimportant. The next story was that there was nothing untoward discussed in those meetings, that they were a matter of course, normal kinds of conversations during a campaign between a nominee and an important foreign country and officials of that country. But we now learn, and again, there's documentation, there are emails that describe that Russians were offering damaging information on then-nominee Trump's political opponent, Hillary Clinton. And in more than one instance, beyond the Trump Tower meeting in June of 2016, now George Papadopoulos describing other Russians offering him similar dirt, as it was described in the court documents. So the story has changed a number of times, and each time it's expanding. And we know that this is very much of interest to the special counsel's investigation.
Jim, I want to stick with you for a moment because I understand you have been doing more reporting late tonight on the Russia investigation. What do you know?
That's right. The New York Times a short time ago broke a story that said that Carter Page had, in fact, met with Russian, at least one Russian government official during a trip to Moscow in the summer of 2016. I have since spoken to Carter Page himself just a couple of minutes ago. He confirms that this is true. He says, though, that this was not a formal meeting, that he met, in his words, this Russian official. They were at the same event. They were both speaking at the same event at the New Economic School in Moscow, and that he met him there, he said, as a matter of course, because they were both participating in the same event. This person, I should add, was a senior Russian official, a deputy foreign minister of Russia. And I just want to look down at my notes here because I want to spell his, I want to pronounce his name correctly. It's Arkady, and I just have to get it right.
That's all right. Take your time. It's Friday night.
Come back at me so I get it right, because I don't want to misstate it. But it was a deputy foreign minister of Russia. And again, Carter Page confirmed it took place. But again, he says it was not two officials sitting at either end of a conference room table, but that he met him as a matter of course during an event that they were both taking part in. Now, the trouble, of course, is that in previous interviews, when asked about these kinds of meetings in the past, Carter Page has denied that they've taken place.
Matt, I want to bring you in, Hannah. You heard that the president say today that he doesn't remember that National Security Campaign meeting where Papadopoulos proposed a Putin meeting. But it was just last week that he said this. Watch this.
There's no hesitation. One of the great memories of all time.
So does the president have a selective memory? It was in July that he told the New York Times he didn't remember details about his one-on-one meeting with Comey.
Well, I think he's like everybody else. He doesn't remember everything. He should quit bragging about having a great memory. He's human. And so maybe he doesn't remember that. That's plausible. He meets a ton of people. Who knows? But look, the problem is it's hard to give any of these people the benefit of the doubt, right? Carter Page, what he just explained makes perfect sense. You're speaking at an event. You bump into somebody else who's speaking there. Is that a meeting? I don't know if that qualifies as a meeting. If that was the only instance, then you could just, you know, give him the benefit of the doubt. But it's like these things keep coming up. Mm-hmm. And so it's really hard to give these guys the benefit of the doubt because there's always, whatever they're saying, there's another shoe to drop.
Yeah, the president is saying he doesn't remember another person in that meeting. J.D. Gordon told CNN Trump heard Papadopoulos out. What do you think?
Who knows about that? What I've been saying all along is they better be telling the truth, okay? Because you've got this investigation now where you have the ability to indict people and squeeze them. You've had no-knock raids on people's houses. You've had their storage facilities raided. You've had Donald Trump's security guard, I think, is going to be questioned now. Anybody who's lying about anything right now could go to jail just for that. You know, if you're lying to the FBI, that is a crime. They are putting the squeeze on these people. And I do think some of these, especially the younger folk here, may be stupid enough to really get themselves in trouble.
Yeah. Margaret, I want to bring you in. And listen, Margaret, I cover this every single night, and there's a lot of information. It's confusing. Right? You're like, wait a minute, what's happening with this person? What's happening with this person? President Trump's longtime advisor, former bodyguard, as Matt just mentioned, and confidant Keith Schiller, will face a wide range of questions on Tuesday from congressional investigators, including on the president's 2013 Moscow trip and the firing of the former FBI director James Comey. He only left the White House in September. And again, when the president says this investigation has nothing to do with him, he's wrong.
Keith Schiller, you cannot overstate how close these two men are, what a confidant he has been to President Trump, how sort of unmoored the president felt in those initial days after Schiller left his post at the White House and returned to the private sector. What he saw, what he heard, obviously that's going to be of intense interest to investigators and to lawmakers. What he's going to share with them and what he actually did here is another matter. And when you talk about loyalists to the president, I'd be hard-pressed to think of many people who are either closer or more loyal.
Margaret, you're right. You could hardly get a picture with the candidate Trump, you know, the real estate person, the candidate, and then as president without Schiller in the picture. I mean, they were together pretty much all of the time. Jim, Carter Page spoke to Jake Tapper, as we've been talking about there. But listen, I want to move on because I want to talk about how significant these developments could be and what could come next week. Could more be coming next week?
Well, listen, just on Carter Page now. So as we said earlier, I spoke to Carter Page tonight. He confirms what was first reported in the New York Times, that during this visit to Moscow in the summer of 2016, he met with someone who was quite a senior Russian official. His name, just to be clear, and I wanted to make sure I pronounced this correctly, but the Deputy Prime Minister, Arkady Dvorkovich. Like I said, Carter Page describes this not as a formal meeting, but that he met him in the course of an event in which they were both speaking in Moscow at the New Economic School of Russia. And he described that meeting as sort of a passerby kind of meeting, met in the hallway, backstage, before they were both speaking at this event. But to be clear, Carter Page was on our air just a number of hours ago. Jake Tapper spoke to him at length for a number of minutes and asked him a number of questions about whether meetings in this category took place, and he didn't say so. And now we are learning, and again, I just spoke to him on the phone, him saying that yes, indeed it did. But to be clear, from his perspective, it is something that he does not describe as a formal meeting. That said, of interest enough that we know that it was something that the House Intelligence Committee was questioning him about when he appeared earlier this week for a number of hours before the House Intelligence Committee, which is, of course, as part of its investigation, looking at Russian interference in the U.S. election. So as part of that questioning, this was a topic that came up, and he faced some hard questions about that.
Thank you all. It's been a long week. Get some rest, recharge, because next week I have a feeling will be another long week as well. I appreciate it. When we come back, Attorney General Jeff Sessions denied meeting with Russians before correcting himself. Is he in legal trouble? I'll ask my expert.
Enjoy the fresher things in life. Fresh towels, fresh soaps, and of course, TripAdvisor's freshest, lowest prices. So, if you're anything like me, you'll want to check TripAdvisor. We now instantly compare prices from over 200 booking sites to find you the lowest price on the hotel you want. Go on, try something fresh. TripAdvisor, the latest reviews, the lowest prices.
I didn't realize how bad my smile was with fillings and root canals. I had to do something. I looked at partial bridges. I looked at dentures. Out of all the options, Clear Choice was the only choice for me.
At Clear Choice, we bring hope to millions who suffer from missing or failing teeth with dental implants that look, feel, and function like strong, natural teeth.
All the specialists with all the technology they need are in one spot. That makes delivering this 21st century world-class dentistry very easy to do, and we do it in one day.
I can laugh, people crack a joke, and I smile. It was a life-changing thing.
Call today to schedule your free comprehensive consultation, an ICAT 3D imaging scan. We'll even talk financing options while you're here.
They not only helped rebuild my smile, but helped me to rebuild my self-confidence. They really set me free. I mean, look at this smile.
At Clear Choice, you're about to discover what you've been missing all these years. Call Clear Choice today.
When you have type 2 diabetes, you manage your A1C, but you also have a higher risk of heart attack or stroke. Non-insulin Victoza lowers A1C and now reduces cardiovascular risk.
Victoza lowers my A1C and blood sugar better than the leading branded pill.
And for people with type 2 diabetes treating cardiovascular disease, Victoza is now approved to lower the risk of major cardiovascular events such as heart attack, stroke, or death.
And while it isn't for weight loss, Victoza may help you lose some weight.
Victoza is not for people with type 1 diabetes or diabetic ketoacidosis. Do not take Victoza if you have a personal or family history of medullary thyroid cancer, multiple endocrine neoplasia syndrome type 2, or if you are allergic to Victoza or any of its ingredients. Stop taking Victoza and get medical help right away if you get symptoms of a serious allergic reaction, such as rash, swelling, difficulty breathing or swallowing. Serious side effects may happen, including pancreatitis. So stop taking Victoza and call your doctor right away if you have severe pain in your stomach area. Tell your doctor your medical history. Gallbladder problems have happened in some people. Tell your doctor right away if you get symptoms. Taking Victoza with the sulfonylurea or insulin may cause low blood sugar. Common side effects are nausea, diarrhea, vomiting, decreased appetite, indigestion, and constipation. Side effects can lead to dehydration, which may cause kidney problems.
Ask your doctor about Victoza.
Welcome back. Before taking off on his Asia trip today, President Trump answered a few questions from reporters, and there's some bad news for Jeff Sessions. The president didn't rule out firing his attorney general.
We're going to Pearl Harbor. I don't know. I'm really not involved with the Justice Department. I'd like to let it run itself. But honestly, they should be looking at the Democrats. They should be looking at Podesta and all of that dishonesty. They should be looking at a lot of things. And a lot of people are disappointed in the Justice Department, including me.
Let's discuss now CNN legal analyst Laura Coates, former federal prosecutor Renato Mariotti, and John Flannery, former federal prosecutor for the Southern District of New York. Welcome to the program. Good evening, all.
Hi.
So, Laura, the president is under the gun when it comes to Russia. And as usual, he's trying to deflect, today refusing to rule out firing his attorney general and pushing the Justice Department to go after his political enemies. Is it just the latest outrageous statement meant to distract?
I think it's probably a distraction and intentional trying to distract, but I think it's also confirmation that he really fundamentally misunderstands how this whole thing works. The fact that he is not supposed to interfere with the FBI or with Justice Department, not because they're trying to inconvenience him, but because as a matter of policy, you want those agencies to be independent. They are not the marionettes of the President of the United States. They're supposed to make independent decisions based on their prosecutorial discretion, not about the vengeance or axes that are ground by the White House.
So, John, former President Obama aide Tommy Vietor, if the press uncovered, tweeted this, that if the press uncovered secret conversations between Trump and DOJ where he pushed the FBI to investigate Hillary, it would be a massive scandal, Watergate level. But when he tweets it repeatedly, it gets brushed off. Do you agree? What would be the consequences?
Well, I do agree with that. There's like no boundaries for this fella. And it's like he deflects a punch by talking about what we should be doing about the Democrats. And he's fixed in the same thing in the election that got him into this trouble. That is to say that he's looking for stuff against Hillary and he can't get over the fact that the FBI has twice cleared her. And so what does he expect the department to do? But he still talks about it because it's the only thing he can latch onto because he can't talk about anything else. And I think secretly or not, he's prepared to do the most boorish things. I mean, he is the original bull in a china shop, and the china shop is our legal system.
Interesting. Renato, Attorney General Jeff Sessions denied meeting with Russians before correcting himself. He also said he didn't know of anyone from the campaign who did. This week's revelations contradict that. So is Sessions in any legal trouble here?
Well, I think he is.
That's for Renato. Renato.
Yeah, sorry. Pardon me.
That's okay. Don, what I would say is Mr. Sessions, in his testimony before Congress, did, I'd say, an expert job of avoiding answering questions. He tried to, when he was giving the answer that you talked about, he tried to qualify it later. I think at one point in the transcript, he did, I think, directly say what you just mentioned. But at many other points, he would say, well, when they would ask him, you know, were you aware of meetings with Russian officials? He'd say, well, I was not aware of any meetings involving collusion or inclusion that would affect the election. He was always trying to qualify them. So, I think that realistically, much of what he said sounded evasive but wasn't chargeable. It's possible that there may be a statement or two to Congress that is chargeable as a crime. That, you know, as viewers may not know, lying to Congress is a crime, but you have to prove that he knowingly did so. So I imagine the defense is going to be from Jeff Sessions and his team is that he didn't remember at the time, you know, he misremembered, et cetera. Mm-hmm. Those cases can be more challenging to prove than you think. And I certainly do think that the Attorney General is doing his very best to expertly avoid, you know, being charged with a crime.
So, Laura, should Sessions come back to correct his testimony to Congress?
Well, I mean, if they'll have him, and I'm sure they would welcome it. However, it would put him, I think, into greater legal jeopardy for this reason. You know, selective amnesia really does breed suspicion and increased scrutiny. I mean, part of the role of the FBI and any investigator worth his or her chops is to have their spine, you know, their hairs on the back of their neck raised whenever somebody tries to qualify statements and give different caveats and contingencies to try to make their statement make sense. And I think that's what's going to get him in the most trouble of all, is that he continues to try to give different reiterations of what he's originally said. And it probably would behoove him at this point, knowing that he is the head of the Justice Department, really, and the top attorney in the land, although Rosenstein, arguably, because he's, you know, now his in his stead. But as a top attorney in the land, I think he should know better than anyone else that to qualify statements and continue to try to re-explain them would put him in jeopardy and have accusations of perjury be much more, supported than they would before.
So, John, you want to weigh in?
Yeah, one of the things that's interesting about his lack of memory is that he doesn't remember any meetings. And then when he's confronted with the meeting with Papadakis, he says he knows specifically what happened at it, and he speaks against the trip to Russia. So the meeting he didn't remember, he now remembers what was said at it, and it's an exculpatory statement when you're considering whether or not the campaign is mixing visits and associations with Russians during the campaign. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of thing you would look at, this kind of selective memory that Laura was referencing, when you have a person who he remembers no meetings and had nothing to do with the campaign, now forced to confront things, he grudgingly admits what he's confronted with and no more, and he now also remembers that he said affirmatively we shouldn't have any trips, and then there are, of course, trips.
Yeah. Hey, Renato, we talked about this a little bit in the last segment. CNN has learned that longtime Donald Trump bodyguard Keith Schiller, will be questioned by investigators about the president's trip to Russia in 2013. What kind of questions do you expect investigators will ask him?
Wow. Well, whenever you have somebody with that level of access to the president, I would think investigators are going to ask him everything that the president heard, everything the president said, everything that the president reacted to or whatever feelings he had, really trying to get a complete picture of what the president did, saw, heard, and who he interacted with when he was in Russia. I mean, someone like that man is very much like a human recording device to the extent to which he's truthful and forthcoming.
Yeah, John, what do you want to say?
There's a very interesting way to do that, which follows these categories, which is to take the emails that Trump Jr. had that he first lied about and to drill down with the correspondence with the person who was with Trump back in 2013 at the beauty contest and with his bodyguard and who is arranging the meeting at Trump Tower during the election to get the dirt from the prosecutor general of Russia by a former prosecutor, Russian prosecutor from Moscow. That's really pertinent stuff. And he may, quote, not recall anything, but I think his energy will be focused when the FBI's talking.
Speaking of what they're going to ask him, go ahead, Laura.
And here is why the timing is so important. Remember, 2013 is the time that Donald Trump went to Moscow for that Miss Universe pageant, and the bodyguard was accompanying him on that particular trip. But you may think to yourself, well, 2013 predates the presidential election and probably before the president of the United States even declared that he was running for office. So why is that important? And that's where you have the domino effect of what happened with Mueller's indictments for Manafort and Gates. The idea that during the course of an investigation that was set centered around the collusion alleged during the campaign, you have to figure out where the foundation for potential interference would come from. Was there information in the dossier? Was information that was gleaned in 2013 that would have compromised now President of the United States in a way that would have made his team more susceptible to being involved in collusion? So you've got Manafort and Gates' indictments. You've got.
Thank you all. I appreciate it. When we come back, the president attacking one of his favorite targets. Guess who? Hillary Clinton, and Clinton's own party may be giving him the ammo.
What is life? Life is about love.
I've always been a polygamist, and I didn't know it.
However unconventional it may be.
People will say it's crazy, loving another man who's married.
Had you ever gone on a blind date with two women before?
No, they're the first couple I've dated.
If you're into it for sex, you are into it for the wrong reasons, and it's not gonna last.
This is Life with Lisa Lang, Sunday night at 10 on CNN.
Who says you can't give yourself a gift for the holidays? Treat yourself with deals like a Ludwig Breakbeat Shell Pack by Questlove, $3.19, or a Simmons SD350E Kit, $2.99. This holiday season, find your sound at Guitar Center.
How do we deliver the best investment strategies possible? By researching hundreds of them every year and filtering out the weak ones until only those that fit investors' needs and our standards remain. Because if they don't make sense to us, they don't make it to our investors.
I got a mortgage offer from the bank today.
What? You never just get one offer. Go to LendingTree.com and shop multiple loan offers for free.
Free?
Yeah, could save thousands. You should probably buy me dinner.
No.
Go to LendingTree.com for a new home loan or refinance. Receive up to 5 free offers and choose the loan that's right for you. Our average customer could lower their monthly bills by over $300. Go to LendingTree.com right now.
Carrie, as a recruiter, you've redefined success at this company. With Paycor, you brought us better processes and a smarter way to hire. And looking around, I guess it worked. So thank you for improving the lives of each person you've hired, including me.
Publishers Clearing House is ready to award the new Turn Back Time Prize. 10 years of back payments right away. That's $2.6 million. Then $5,000 a week for life. Don't miss your last chance to win. Enter at PCH.com now on December 22nd. It could be you.
Anthony Bourdain in Puerto Rico.
What will happen to this beautiful place?
All new Anthony Bourdain Parts Unknown, Puerto Rico, Sunday at 9 on CNN. Missed an episode? Season 10 is on iTunes now.
I'm always amazed at how far people travel to come to Floors USA. And the minute they walk in the door, they know why their friends told them to come here.
It's our annual Fall Savings Days. If it's in stock, it's on sale. And for a limited time only, get 36-month interest-free financing on the largest selection of in-stock flooring and area rugs under one roof in the Delaware Valley. Hurry in. If it's in stock, it's on sale. Plus, no interest until 2020.
Floors USA. Better flooring at better prices, guaranteed.
This holiday, let QVC be your guide. We'll help you find cool and unique gifts, specially curated for everyone on your list. Like your favorite techie, a secret Santa, any beauty buff, even you. Find